Aloha and mahalo. Welcome. Anyone can watch. I'm not a spiritual teacher. But you can watch anyway. I'm not anyone's guru. I'm not anyone's teacher. But that doesn't mean you can't watch and listen, right? Just a friend. Just a friend. But a materialistic friend, actually, now. I'm going to go materialistic. That's right. What? Yeah. There's an abundance of caution. Got to sit out the last dance of spirituality, right? We're in this phase called the last dance phase. You know, and so all those ones have been on the sidelines saying, no, I don't want to dance the dance of spirituality. It's now, it's like the last dance. And those who think that, you know, the dance of spirituality is it, this is it, but they still feel insecure. Said, God, it's the last dance. They say, I got to get everyone to dance. I got to find the right dance partner. They say, I got to find the right dance partner. That's the problem. So they're, you know, asking, they want to ask those who don't want to dance. Maybe, you know, maybe you're it, you know. Come on, let's dance. Let's everybody dance. Everybody dance. That kind of thing. Everybody dance. And that'll work out. So I got to walk out of the dance hall, you know, of spirituality. So the way to do that is to be a materialist for a while. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be a real materialist, not even a spiritual materialist, just a materialist. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to be like Trump, be on the golf course, materialist. Absolutely, I will. Abundance of caution. You do not want to dance the last dance of spirituality. I don't need to be a guru. I don't have desire to be a guru teaching spirituality or whatever. You know, I don't. I already have it. I already have it. It's not profound. It's simple. It's the opposite of profundity. It's not even the opposite. The real task is to go from profundity, is to drop profundity for utter simplicity. There's nothing profound about reality at all. And so spirituality is this dance of profundity. You know, everyone wants to get this, oh, I gotta be profound. Now that's the problem. That's what's getting in the way. That's pretense. That's getting in the way. So we're exiting this phase of profundity, of spirituality. Spirituality is what we need to set down. But just like alcoholics at a bar, you know, last call, and they're saying, yeah, there are all these alcoholics. Let's say, oh, you walk in this bar, and there's all these alcoholics there. Then, but they're not drinking. They have their glasses there, but they're not drinking. They're talking about their cures. Says, yeah, I really need to sober up. You know, I'm really working on my sobriety, and I think sobriety is a great thing. I think sobriety is very profound. I think sobriety is going to make me happy. And then someone says, okay, last call. It's like, last call. Oh my God. You know, fill it up. And they're grabbing all the bottles, you know, give me all the bottles. I'll take them home with me. You know, the bottles of spirituality, the drug. Spirituality is a drug. It's an addiction. It's the worst addiction there is, actually. It's the final addiction. You must break the spirituality addiction. It's the worst addiction there is. Okay, and everybody's talking like, oh yes, yeah, it's very profound. I have something very profound. Yeah, I need to sober up. But now, when it comes time to sober up, oh no. Hey, I just need a better guru, you know, more profound guru who'll teach even better spirituality. So, for me, I need to make myself scarce, you know, from the scene. I'm nobody's guru. I'm nobody's dance partner. Never have been. I can see death and dissolution. Boom. I know exactly what it is. Okay. All pretense. Just see it simply like that, and it's not profound. It's just simple. There's not this feeling of profundity. It's simple. Okay, but the bridge between profundity and simplicity is wow. It's the wow bridge. So the wow practice is to help you get from profundity, spirituality, to simplicity, utter simplicity. It's spirituality. That's what we need to be liberated from, okay? And right now, people are not, they're ambivalent. So it's a very dangerous time, very dangerous time. Driving men to suicide. The women say, let's dance. The ambivalence of what to do right now is so strong. And men, a lot of men feel like they need to do what women want, okay? That's to be a man. We're taught is to do what women want you to do. If women want you to build a house, you build a house. If women want you to do this, want you to be a guru, you become a guru. That's what men do. They do what women tell them to do. So right now, women are so ambivalent. This is driving men to suicide, actually. So what men need to do is take a step back into materiality, okay, and say, you know what? I'm going to be a materialist for a while. I'm going to go play golf with the guys. Yeah, that will prevent suicide in men. And so women, you know, settle down from this ambivalence, driving men crazy. Absolutely it is. Men don't know what the heck women want because women don't know what they want. They say, I want spirituality, but I don't want it. I want it, but I don't want it. So, you know, like what? And without the wow practice, you know, men will be driven to suicide. They can take refuge in materiality or the wow practice. But women aren't ready right now to give up spirituality. They're ambivalent about it because they were supposed to be the goddesses of spirituality. They were going to run the whole show. See? They're going to be the ones that totally large, you know, in control. Well, they always have been. It's just they thought, but this is it. That if they tell men, okay, this is your role, and men say, okay, and they do the spirituality thing, that's going to be it. And yet they already realize it's not it. So they don't know what to tell men to do. They don't know what to say. And they just say, okay, let's just do this one last dance, you know, but that's a frantic dance, you know. Got to be spiritual. And drive men crazy. So men, you need to back off. The genders need to separate, back off from one another right now. But of course, forbidden, how you do that? You go play golf. So I'll invite all the guys to go play golf. I won't invite the gals to play golf at this point. No. Because the two genders need to take their own counsel right now. The ambivalence of females right now is driving men crazy. Men need to stay away from them right now. But of course, for a while, men are kind of scared. Say, but I won't know what to do then. You know, I need women to tell me what to do. I say, it's simpler than that. Okay, don't worry. So I'm just giving this faith. Don't worry. It's actually way simpler than that. So play golf for a while. Be a materialist. Guys, be materialistic for a while. Drop spirituality. Okay, drop it. I give you permission to drop it. Now, women don't want you to suicide. They don't. But they can't help it. They're so ambivalent now, they're driving men to suicide. And it's just the way it is. So, you know, don't blame. We're not playing the blame game here at all. It's just we're playing the pragmatic game. I said, guys, just get away from women. Go play golf for a while. And the wise women will say, you know what? Go play golf, guys. I am just going crazy for a while. When the guys will say, but I need you to, you know, I need to do what you want me to do. I need to please you. I need to do what you want. I say, no, don't worry about that. Don't worry about that right now. I can't really be pleased. I'm, you know. I'm PDS. I have PDS syndrome. Pre-dropping spirituality syndrome. So women have this PDS syndrome. All the women in the world have PDS. So guys, you know, just stay away from them. And they will get it too. They'll say, yeah, that's the smart thing to do. Just stay away from me right now. If you ever been with a woman that has a PMS, you realize that like you're like the worst person in the world. And you can do no right. You can do no right. You can only do wrong, and it drives you crazy, almost drives you to suicide, almost, actually. PMS almost drives men to suicide. It's so terrible. That's why guys just, you know, go out in the golf course, and And then later on, they're perfectly fine. Like, what's the matter? You know, like, oh, you're back, good. And like, are you normal again? It's like, oh yeah, I feel fine. Great. So P, so women have PDS right now, pre-dropping spirituality syndrome, the PDS syndrome. So guys, just stay away from them. It's plain and simple. So I have to set the example. Just stay away. Stay away. No counseling, you know, no teaching, no helping, nothing else. Because you'll be driven to suicide if you're not careful. Either a nervous breakdown or suicide, and two are pretty much linked, because most guys, when they have a nervous breakdown, they go to drugs, alcohol, you know, fornication, all sorts of stuff, and then that leads to suicide. So it's better to go play golf. So that's why I'm a golfer now. I'm a golfer. I've been working out in my golf swing and my golf clothes. I got all my golf stuff ready to go. Absolutely, I do. I got my reward points from God waiting for me. I don't know how many I have, because I never pay any attention to that, because I've gone on faith, and all I've done is my whole life is work, 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 work for God. That's it. I have not counted any reward points at all. So I have no idea what my reward points are. Is it, you know, one reward point or a trillion? I don't know. I don't care. It's up to God. My job is just to work as hard as I possibly can. And I have great faith in God, the Dharma Kings. All my reward points are with them. It's up to them how to use them on my behalf. You know, I said, go ahead, use them on my behalf if that's what you want to do. I'm okay with that. So, I don't know. But when God says you've done a great job, which He has to me, you got to imagine I got a few reward points, a bit of merit stored up. I maybe accumulated interest, because I haven't drawn on it yet, you know. So it's probably a lot of, you know, interest. I don't know. I really don't know. I never think about it. I've never thought about it. But that's what the Dharma Kings are looking for. Someone who never even thinks about reward, just doing, just working, just does the work. And that's what I've done. So we'll see how it plays out. I just have to accept it. I mean, God's been telling me that you need to do this. I say, oh, but God, that's not spiritual. He says, ah, that's right. But you don't need spiritual, do you? I say, no, I don't. So I'm going to go materialistic for a while, which is abundance of caution. You see, you have to stay away from any notion of spirituality. No spirituality here. No, no. Nah, I'm just working out, just playing golf. Eating nice restaurants and driving a nice car and just playing golf and just being a complete materialist. Yeah, absolutely. But a committed materialist. Yeah. No spirituality. What are you talking about? I don't know anything about it. All talk is just talk. Spirituality talk is just talk. That's all that it is. That's the real materialism, actually. That's the real materialism. So you got to stay away from fake, you know, the faking that you're not materialistic. Stay away from that by being, you know, just genuinely materialistic and not try to fake it, but not be in that way. That protects you. So I can do that. I can do that. Because I'm secure. I'm secure in simplicity. I feel secure in simplicity. There's no spirituality to reality at all. It's just utter simplicity. There's no profundity to it at all. How could there be? It's always been this way. We didn't do anything to make it this way. It's just naturally the way everything is, the way it is. Now, because we're so used to spirituality, so familiar with it, there's a tremendous familiarity bias, and we cannot just drop the profound. So what do? You flatten it all. You flatten it all out, and you do that through the WOW practice. That's all the WOW practice does. Everything is WOW. There's no elaboration at all. And so you practice non-elaboration of profundity by, oh, this is WOW. Yeah, this is WOW. I was practicing it this morning, and it's tremendous. You flatten all profanity, all spirituality is flattened out into wow. Simplicity, oh, it's wow. Gurus are wow. Non-gurus are wow. Everything is simply wow. So that's the one profanity you allow yourself. You don't allow yourself any other profanity. You don't allow yourself any other spirituality. Okay, just wow. That's all that you allow yourself. And it works. And it works. You flatten all profanity out. And then ultimately, when all profanity is flattened out, you look at it and you say, oh, it's so simple. And then, there you go. But first, you have to cross the bridge of wow, which is flatten all spirituality, all profundity out. Flatten it out in the wow. So this is what I've been practicing for quite some time to see if it works and for my own benefit as well. And it does work. It does work. Reality is totally other than spirituality. There's nothing spiritual about reality as far as spirituality. There's nothing like that. No. And it's not also saying I'm being profoundly unprofound. Profoundly non-profound. That's also spirituality. That's the trap. That's a trap, isn't it? I say, look how profoundly non-spiritual I'm being. That's also the profanity trap. So if you're going to be conscious, like I'm just going to be a materialist, okay. That's a protection from profundity, but I don't see any profundity in being going and play golf. That's not profound either. That's wow too. That's wow too. So I'll continue the wow practice is what I will do. So it's not the crazy wisdom thing. So look how non-spiritual I am. It's not that. It's not that. Because that's also a trap. You know, that's the spiritual teacher trying to, you know, the one who wants to be the guru, say, look how non-guru-ish I am. Look how non-spiritual I am. I'm beyond profundity and spirituality. I'm this great teacher, you know. But they really are still craving, you know, the guru role. That's what's still there. They're trying to be profoundly non-profound. So the crazy wisdom thing is also still spirituality. It's still spirituality. So the way to get past even the crazy wisdom thing is just the wow practice. Because you see the crazy wisdom, what happens? Oh, all these spiritual types are just flock to them. Say, oh my God, you're so spiritual. This is so wonderful. You know, I could feel the spirituality. And it comes out down the road. You find out that one who professed to be beyond spirituality, crazy wisdom thing, was really, you know, just craving to be the ultimate in spirituality. So I'm the greatest. I am the God of spirituality. You know, I'm the greatest God of spirituality there's ever been. That's what they're craving, actually. And then down the road that comes out, and it's like, wow. And it gets really sad. It gets really yucky. So the way past that is the WOW practice. It's like you say, you're non-spiritual? WOW. You're spiritual? WOW. You're beyond, you're beyond it all? WOW. Okay. You're not beyond it all? WOW. Okay. You don't say, WOW, it's that's profound. No, you say, just WOW. You don't, okay, so the, hear this. You don't say, wow, that's so profound. You don't say that. Okay, then that's a, that you're right back in the trap that we're trying to avoid. You just say, wow, that's all. So as soon as you actually do that, you will feel it. You will know the practice. You will know it. As soon as you just, not, oh, wow, how profound. Oh, wow, how beyond spirituality that is. Oh, no, it's just wow. Just wow. And that's where you feel the burn then. You will feel this burn, like, oh my gosh, what is this? Burning away the interest in the profound, really. By just holding on to just one profundity. Wow is all there is. That's it. Wow is wow. It really works. It really works. This is what works. And one day soon, we'll really have lost interest in the world and the universe. This dream, we'll just simply lose interest in it. But first, we have to flatten profundity. Okay? Have to flatten it, absolutely flatten it. You can't have flatness when you say, wow, this is profound. That's not flatness. Because then you're seeing the wow is profound. And there's depth to it. No, it's just wow. That's all. But then when you practice this, you'll feel the burn. You will feel that there's some intensity of the burn. Like, oh, I wanna, you know, make the wow profound. But no, it's just wow. The profound wow is wow. Also. And you'll feel like your nerves just like, you feel like, oh, I just gotta do it, but I can't do it. And feel the burn, as I call it, the burn. It's wonderful. That means you're really making headway, actually. I love the burn. I've been through it for years, and haven't I? On the videos, you've seen it. And I've been going through it now. Last night, I tried to get the burn. I have no interest in this world whatsoever, actually. And I was just saying, okay, you know, this is how I feel. But I didn't get much burn out of it. I say, I was disappointed. I said, come on. This universe, I have no interest in this universe. I don't. But to bring it closer to home, I have zero interest in this world. I really do. This is how I feel. There's nothing about this world that I'm interested in at all. But I can practice saying, you know, no interest in the world, wow. Interest in the world, wow. You know, no interest in this, wow. I have no interest in the ocean, wow. I have no interest in waves, wow. See, I have no interest in mountains, wow. I have no interest in people, wow. I have no interest in babies, wow. I have no interest in personalities, wow. I have no interest in life. Wow. I have no interest in this. Wow. Just say wow. Just wow. So all spirituality is reduced simply to wow. Okay, all profanity, you reduce it to just wow. That's it. Goodbye addiction. Goodbye spirituality addiction. Okay, but it's work, okay? It's really, it's breaking the addiction. It's really the work of getting free of this addiction. So, unless you really apply yourself and feel the burn, it's there, and it's awesome because you'll feel like you got to have that drink. You'll get the jitters, like the addiction jitters. I just got to have that drink. You'll be shaking. And you just sit there and smile and just say, no, wow. That's all there is, wow. This is just wow. Full stop in the wow. You just do full stop in the wow. And then gradually the jitters will wear off. you feel desperate for that drink, that spirit drink of spirituality. And gradually the jitters wear off. And he goes, I did it. I can do this. I can do this. But you have to prove it to yourself. You don't prove it to me is nothing. It means nothing to prove it to me. Okay. Proving it to me doesn't mean anything. So I don't have any students or any. So the students want to prove something to the teacher. That's nothing. That's nothing. You have to prove it to yourself. Proving it to the teacher is just a spirituality game again. And then you're putting the teacher in the role of a spiritual teacher. So I'm not a spiritual teacher at all. I'm not a teacher at all. I'm just saying, I'm a friend who's just saying, you have to prove this to yourself. You have to go through it for yourself. You can't just say to the teacher, did I do it? Did I do it? That gets nowhere. You have to actually do it so you experience it for yourself and you say, I did it. So then you're the teacher. You're your own teacher, actually. You see, you are the superstar of your path. You are the guru of your path. You are the teacher of the path. You're the one, not me. I'm not the guru of anyone's path. You are. You're the guru of your own path. But there's this phase right now before we finally, people, we all commit to that. That's the next chapter, is we're committing to be, we're the guru, we're the real guru, okay, of our own path. Which means we actually succeed. We actually do it. You realize, I did it. I can, and that means I can do this. I can do it again. Break this spirituality addiction. Then you'll feel like, hey, I am the guru. Yeah, I really am. But you have to actually experience this, that you succeeded, in order to feel this way. You can never feel this way by just trying to please some external guru. That will never do it for you. Will never do it for you. It's like going to Ramadan and saying all this heart talk. Ramana is just completely uninterested in that. Just said all heart talk is just talk. It's nothing. It's not it. Okay. But Ramana, you know, maybe you didn't like this, you know, how I look, or I didn't shed enough tears for you, or I didn't sing a bhajan for you or something. So all bhajans are just bhajan talk, you know. All spirituality is just spirituality junk. It's just addiction. It's just an addiction, okay. So he was like totally resolute about this, you know. Just the ultimate, right? Nothing interest about the world interested him at all. So this is what we're headed towards. If we want Ramana, more Ramanas in the world, we can't throw this spirituality. We got to break our spirituality addiction. And we do this through the WOW practice, flattening all profundity, okay, flattening it. Ramana, WOW. That's WOW. The toilet is WOW. WOW. It's just WOW. It's not what a profound toilet. No, it's just WOW. Okay, get that. Hear that? There's no duality about it. It's been flattened into just WOW. That profound toilet has just been flattened into WOW the same way that profound Rama Maharshi has just been flattened into WOW. This is how we break the spirituality addiction. But right now, the ambivalence is such that people are like, last call before, you know, we have to break the addiction. One more drink and then I'll be okay. As George Jones says, one drink, just one more, and then another. Yeah. Put the bottle on the table. Let it stay there till I'm not able to see your face in any place that I go. I've been sitting here so long, just remembering that you're gone. Well, one more drink of wine. And then if you're still on my mind, one drink, just one more, and then another. That's the spirituality addiction. Okay? Now you might be saying, "Well, that's not fair. It's so difficult." No, it's not. I've done it. It's not too difficult. It's enjoyable to break an addiction. Breaking addictions is enjoyable, actually. I've broken a lot of addictions. I got addicted to stuff, and then just to break them, to see, oh, that's kind of fun. Okay, but right now, we need to break the spirituality addiction. It's fun to break an addiction. It really is. It's like, oh my gosh, I am the guru. I really am the guru. Discovering that you really are the guru is a lot of fun, actually. What could be more fun than that? So I'll just go play golf with Trump, for now. Yeah. Trump's like, spirituality? I don't know that. I don't know what that is. I don't have time for that. So I don't have time for that. Right, yeah. It's great. Get on the Trump train, everybody. Right? Break your addiction to spirituality. You're the guru. And then you will prove to yourself that you are the guru, which means you can handle then utter simplicity. Only the guru can handle utter simplicity, right? But you are the guru. You're the one that can do that because you're the guru. But you have to first prove to yourself that you're the guru. So that means you're the superstar of the path. I'm the lowest of the low. How can I be a guru? I'm the lowest of the low right now. I'm the spokesman for the Dharma Kings, the WOW practice spokesman. But that means I'm a spokesman, not a guru. Right? And lowest of the low. So I can talk about the WOW practice, but only as a spokesman for it. A spokesman to remind you that you're the guru. Not me. Not me. I'm just a, materialist playing golf. I've already done it, so I don't need to prove to myself that I'm the guru. I've already done it. You need to do it, you see? So if I start try to play the guru thing, they'll just get in your way. They'll just get in your way. So the next chapter is the WOW practice. That is the next chapter. Flattening profundity is the next chapter. Flattening it. So when the peace of God came upon me, it wasn't profound. It wasn't profound. But I realized that and I said, I'm going to try to attach profundity to it, so I better go wow it. So I wowed it. Okay, I wowed it. That enabled it to remain for quite some time because I just wowed it. I didn't try to attach any spirituality to it or profundity to it. It's not profound. So profundity keeps wanting to have some label, I need to find the right profundity label for it. There's nothing at all you can say about it in terms of profundity. There's nothing at all you can say about it. Except what it's not. I mean, I said, it's imperceptible. It's imperceptibly gentle and soft, imperceptibly so. So you cannot, profundity is based on perception, actually. It's a reaction of perception. But this is imperceptibly the way that it is. Okay, so there's no feeling of profundity. The feeling you might say, you might. People say, well, it's bliss or whatever. I don't know. That's a label too of profundity. So you have to flatten spirituality. You have to flatten profundity in order to experience the peace of God. It's just What it is imperceptible. It's imperceptible. And it's just, you might say, it's just awareness that this, as it is. There's nothing profound. There's no reaction. Oh, this is so profound. Okay. But you need to block the panicking back into a spirituality by wow. So I said, okay, wow, let me just wow. So, I promise you that when you break the addiction to profundity, the peace of God will dawn upon you. For sure it will. For sure it will. And at that point, as you, and then when you, as you get used to that, and ultimately, you'll realize you don't even need to be a guru. You're even not even interested in being a guru at all. Ultimately. But first you have to be the guru of your own path of practice. You are the practice guru. So you get to be a guru for a while. Ultimately, you ultimately, it is true, you will be the same as like Ananda Maimar or Ram Maharshi, such. And they say, I'm nobody's guru. I'm not a guru. I'm nobody's guru. Because they were here to tell us, first, we have to be the guru. That's a stage you go through. And that's, you practice. You must, it's practice flattening all profundity. That's being the guru. Because that's super wise, super skillful means, right? That's the ultimate practice. So only the guru knows the ultimate practice. But so we now know what the ultimate practice is, flattening profundity, breaking the spirituality addiction. So as when you do this, you are the guru. So you get to be a guru for a while. How about that? So I don't want to get in your way. I don't want to be the super guru that gets in your way of being the guru. You are the super guru. You get to be that. So I've already done that. I'm still doing it, but I've already, you know, I'm already so, I've done it for so long. I feel, yeah, I'm Xing out of that stage. I don't really need, I can just be the golfer now or something, whatever. I'm not going to get in your way. You get to be the super guru now. Yeah, and it's fun. It's wonderful. It's like, wow, I always wanted to be a guru, you know, and now you get to be one. It's great. It's awesome. But there's this phase of ambivalence now, like you're not sure. You know, I said, no, I just wanted to be a goddess in service of the great guru. You know, I wanted to be a spirituality goddess. Right? Or spirituality. Yeah, I just wanted to serve the spirituality goddess. You know, there's that ambivalence. I don't know, can I really be the, do I really want to be the guru? So this is the ambivalence that we're in right now. Which again, as I said, the danger is to men right now. Women can handle that much better than men because they're just saying, well, I haven't decided yet. And they're allowed to be indecisive. Okay, but men are not allowed to be indecisive because they're supposed to serve women. And so they have to be decisive about that. Say, okay, I know what I'm doing. This is what you told me to do, and I'm doing it. That's a man. Whereas if women are just so ambivalent, super ambivalent, that then drives men crazy. They can't handle it. They can't handle it. So men just go play golf for a while. So inviting, maybe I'll invite you to go to play golf with me. We'll just have golf tournaments. No, seriously, I'm really serious about this. It's very, very possible. And you just do it. Even if you don't know how to play golf, you say, okay, I gotta learn. I gotta learn. I just gotta go learn to play golf. And it's guys only, you know, that kind of thing. Guys only. Absolutely guys only. The PDS, pre-dropping spirituality syndrome, guys just have to get away from it. They'll end up possibly committing suicide, getting, you know, severe substance problems trying to cope with it, or committing suicide. Absolutely, that's so. And so we can't let that happen. I don't, you know, we cannot. We cannot let that happen. And women say, no, but as soon as I figure out what I want, the mental will be fine. Yeah, but you can't figure out what you want right now. You're in this transitional time where you're like super ambivalent. You know, it's like, so you got to realize that the men have to take a break from women. You need to take a break from women. They have to take a break. Not with a pseudo woman, okay? Not in a gay relationship. No. That's not enough of a break. Okay, that's not enough of a break. That's actually a way of trying to medicate. Okay, it's self-medication. That is not the WOW practice, and that's not going a genuine break from it. Okay, that's still trying to get the directive. So I'm just saying, just go play golf, be materialist for a while. Just take a conscious break. Intentional break from it. So I'm gonna, and I'm giving you permission to do that. Dharmic, you have Dharma King permission to take a break. And you start working on being your own guru. Okay, do the WOW practice. Don't jump into some gay relationship. Okay, you're taking a break from relationship, that whole relationship thing. Okay, you're taking a break from the whole relationship thing, and you're just playing golf and doing the WOW practice. So just be materialistic and do the WOW practice for a while. That's all. And then when women decide, those women decide, okay, they're going to be the guru. Not the goddess, but the guru. Okay, the guru is higher than the goddess. When they decide, then you realize that's what you need to do also. And then you'll really start doing it too. But there's this transitional time where it's a danger time for men. It's a big danger time we're in. Really bad danger time. And so, seriously, it may very well be that I just invite you to come play golf with me. You know, let's play golf for a while. And then you just do it. You say, you know, I need to take a vacation, a break. I just want to go play golf with Clarity Rost, you know. Yeah. All these would be spiritual. No, just playing golf. We'll just go play golf, actually. That's quite possible. I've been told this by the Dharma Kings for my whole life. You're going to be playing golf a lot. You got to get ready for that, which I've been working out like crazy to play golf. I realized my knee, though, it hurts my knee. So I told my knee, okay, you need to not be hurt by it. There's some sort of resistance there, right? It's like, oh. I've been told that. I said, what the heck, you know? I don't get it. What do you mean go play golf? There's nothing spiritual about that. They said, just trust us. You will be playing golf with a lot of people, a lot of men, and this is going to help them out a lot. Because there's a lot of guys in a very similar boat, which they're very, very close, you know, to being the guru of their own practice. But they're still vulnerable to doing what the women tell them to do, you know. Say, this is what we want you to do. And we want you to be a spirituality guru, our spirituality guru. So we don't have to be a real guru. We can be a goddess. You see, this is the thing. Women are struggling. Should I be the guru or the goddess? You got to be the guru. But they're ambivalent right now. So you need to take a break from that. You need to get away from that, actually, and go play golf. And again, I remember the first time I played golf, this guy, who was a really good golfer, just said, I want to play golf today. And I was working for him, and he says, well, your work for today is to go play golf with me. That's how it basically kind of happened. Yeah. I said, I don't have clubs. Well, I got some clubs for you. I don't know how to golf. I'll show you how to golf. Don't worry. That's how it started. Okay, so my boss told me, I want to play golf today, and so your work today is to play golf. As my employee, I'm treating you to a round of golf. That's your work. And so you see, I said, okay, you're the boss. So I went and played golf. And it was amazing. I was horrible. But I was watching him play golf, and I said, my God, this guy is something else. I mean, how's he doing? That's awesome. I loved it. I said, you just hit that drive and just pow. I said, I want to do that. So, I mean, after that, I was hooked on golf. You know, I said, this is, and so I got into it. And I've been into it for 44 years, really. So, again, someone, your boss tells you, you know, we're playing golf today. That's what you do. So I'm telling you, guys, we're playing golf now. Okay, that's what it is. I'm the boss, and we're playing golf. And when, you know, the same thing like corporate. If your boss tells you we're having a golf tournament, you know, and all our customers, vendors, customers, everything are going to be there. Guess what? You have to play golf. You can't beg out of it. Say, boss, I don't have to play golf. I got a bad back. I can't. No, you have to show up, even if it's to drive the drink cart or something. You show up. You don't make an excuse. And this is why we had a golf tournament recently. This business that I'm a good, loyal customer of this business, and they invite me to play golf. They know I'm a golfer, but we're like a really good customer of theirs, and it's important that they treat us. So, of course I showed up. I said I quit golf, but I don't say no when this, you know, the boss, you know, the owner of this business that we're, you know, one of their most important customers, long-time customer for 30 plus years or more, you don't say no, because everyone's going to be there, you know. So I say, yeah, of course I'm going to go. I've quit golf, but for you, I'll play this in this tournament. For sure I will. It's like that. So if you're part of a company or there's some boss that invites you, you don't say no. You don't say no. You go. And so there are a bunch of people there that I asked them, are you going? And say, yeah, but I've never played golf before. They said that. Or I've only played once in my life. A lot of guys who work for them say, I've only played once in my life. But they went. They have to show up. They go. And they had a great time. I said, how was it? I said, oh, man, I had a great time. All my friends were there. You know, we just had a blast. I sucked. I was terrible. You know, but it was best ball anyway. So, you see, in best ball, it doesn't matter if you play terrible. You hit your ball into the bushes or miss it. You swing and miss. You say, take another swing. Eventually you hit it and it goes in the bushes or whatever. That's okay because you got a guy with you playing who plays well and they crush it 300 yards and you play your next shot from there. So then you get to hit a ball from that spot. So you say, wow, I'm kind of close to the green. That's cool. And then you like skull your ball or something, but you know, it still goes somewhere. And then the guy who plays well hits a good shot right in the green. Then you get to putt from that nice place on the green. And then you hit your putt and maybe it goes in the hole and you say, yay, I contributed. So you, even if you've never played golf before, you're able to contribute when you play best ball format. So probably that's what we'll do. We'll play best ball format. It's because if you've never played golf before, and you're playing with someone who knows what they're doing, it will mortify you. It will mortify you. I've had that happen before. It was terrible. It was horrible. The guy was an idiot. I mean, maybe I was an idiot too. So no, we're playing best ball format. No mortification here. And sometimes, you know, we'll take your shot. It's okay if you hit it up near the green. So you know what? Let's go from there. So, you know, you feel you're contributing to the overall success of the situation. And you never had to have played golf in your life to do that. You know, if you can walk, you can play golf. You grab the club, you swing back and forth. You know, I can swing this club. It's just pow. You know, anybody can do it. I mean, you kidding me? Guys can't plead weakness or this. I mean, the gals are out there playing golf like crazy in the world, smashing the ball. I mean, and they're not all muscular. Some of them are, but some of them like more like petite, and they just like a nice, smooth, rhythmic swing. Pow! You know, so there's no excuses, guys. There's no excuses, and we'll play best ball. Now, I've never done that on just a round of golf with somebody. I mean, a tournament I do it, but I've never even thought about doing that with someone goes out and plays golf with you. You just, you know, hit golf their ball and they say, oh, I want to hit it. No. So the rules are best ball. That prevents mortification from setting in, because I've been on the other end of it, playing with people who are really good, and man, it just, you know, I just said, I've had enough, I gotta walk off. It can be mortifying. But if you're playing best ball, you're brought into that format, it's a whole different story. And it's fine. So that's how guys who've never played before play in the company tournament. Best ball. It's four man, best ball. And it's a blast. It's a blast. But you can play two-man best ball, too. I've never thought about that, except for right now. Isn't that fantastic? And you get to go out and wear nice golf resort clothes, you know, and be nice and materialistic. And it's a blast. It's a blast, actually. A lot of camaraderie. A lot of laughs. You hit one in the water, you know, hey, one for the fishes there. You know, that's good. You gotta spread the love around, you know. But yeah, as I have the experience, I had this vendor, someone we were supporting business wise, and they want, I invited him to play golf. They wanted to play golf, and he said he's really good. So I'm really good at it. Well, there's some people and some cultures and traditions and stuff, I didn't know this, that they can't admit they're not good. They're braggers. So we went out, and he said, yeah. Well, he was terrible. And he insisted on playing 18 holes this way. And it just killed him. It just killed him. We never played golf again. So I learned from that mistake. That was horrible. I've never really invited anyone to play golf again since then, because you never know how good people are. They're liars, you know. They won't admit. Say, no, I'm terrible. You know, I don't even know how to play. Because then they think that you won't invite them. So in order to get the invitation, he had to say, oh yeah, I'm really good at golf. I play a lot of golf. Oh yeah. And he said, don't worry. I mean, every time he hit behind the ball and just took out a huge amount of sod, you know, and missed the ball, he'd do like five times in a row or something, and finally hit one and it scored somewhere, and they hit numbers. It'd take him 20 minutes to get to the green, you know. And I said, oh my God, I said, this is horrible. But he refused to give up, you know. He just beat himself into a pulp. Ridiculous. I felt mortified by the whole thing. So that's not going to happen. I'm not going to let that happen. That is for sure. So we're playing best ball. Even if you're good, maybe we're playing best ball. That's a possibility, right? Because we're not after a score. We're just playing golf. We're not after any score at all. We're just out there playing golf. How about that? Wow, what a mind blower this is. Oh my gosh, I've never thought of such a thing until right now. So even if you're a good golfer, scratch golfer, we're still playing best ball. No competition. We're just helping each other play the lowest round possible. So we play best ball, we might shoot a 59 out there or something, you know? No competition. Just take the best ball. So which one should we take? So there's camaraderie, there's cooperation out there. Camaraderie and cooperation. And we just let the gals make up their mind. Right? Yeah. And also, we get to see what it's really about, because it will spread out. Those who go to be the goddess will be the goddess, go for the goddess thing. Those who go to the guru will be the guru thing. They'll decide, then the decision. And then, okay, it'll be a different story, a different chapter at that point. But right now, the ambivalence of women in the world is such that they're like really torn between, should I be the goddess or the guru? You know, should I be the goddess or the guru? Holy cow. So we just, you know, let them decide. They have to decide. It's up to them. But we know, you know, those who play golf, we decide, you know, I'm going to be the guru. I'm going to be the guru. I've decided to be the guru. Yeah. To be the super guru of your own practice. So this is a very exciting moment right now for me. Wow. This is just really blowing my mind. But it's great. Now I feel great. It's exciting. Wow. It's just wow. Is what it is. Unexpected. Beyond my expectations. Is this taping? It is. 55. I looked again. 55. I said, wow, 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 wow. So once again, I'm the guru of my own path here. You know, the super guru of my own path. My own practice here. Wow. I've never heard of two buddies who play golf while going out and playing best ball. I've never heard of that. That's just, and not even in a tournament, just that's how they play. I've never heard of it. It's never been brought up to my attention ever. So this is like a first. Yet I've never heard of two people going out and playing golf in a non-tournament, playing best ball at all. Or for someone who's lousy, being invited just to play best ball. I've never heard of that either. And maybe, you know, parents with their children might do that. I've never heard of it, but certainly I would think that they do that occasionally. I wouldn't be surprised if the kids struggle. They say, okay, just take my drive. Let's go hit from there. And they say, okay. So that builds their confidence. It doesn't mortify the children. Otherwise, if you mortify them, they'll quit the game. For sure. They'll quit it. But in terms of adults, I've never heard of that before. Yeah. Wow. That's very humbling, isn't it? As having faith in that you can be the guru of your own path, I have total faith that you can. So that's why I'm going to, you know, I'm able to set down the rules of it all, you know, set down the format of it. But you can always putt out, you know. You see, that's the thing. Even if you've never played golf before, anybody can just putt a golf ball. So once you're on the green, then it's up to you now. You can putt. And then get the ball in the hole, and you'll say, ha, I did it. You know, and they feel that way. You say, God, at least I got that part. I can do that. And you can get good at putting actually very quickly. You can be very, very good at it. Now, if we want to make a nice score, then you know, maybe we'll take the best putt, you know, and get a feeling like we're getting a good score, or you are not. It depends. We just play it by ear. I'll just work that out. But putting wise, you can do it. You can do it. You know, I'll help get you on the green, and then you putt out. You can putt out. Maybe even two putt. I remember my wife, I got her on a green at par 3 and 1. I said, okay, well, you putt, we'll putt out. She felt, I'm a good putter. I can do this. She feels very good at putting. And she made a birdie. And she goes, yeah! That's like, it was awesome, or something like that. What was it? Now, she hit her drive onto the green, a driver onto the par 3, and then two-putted for a par. She made par or something on her own. And it was like she was so pumped up about that. Yeah. So who knows? I mean, you may be able to hit on a par 3. You might hit your ball on the green. Absolutely. And then two putt for a par. You see, and when you do that, you say, oh my God, I can do this. That'll happen. That'll happen. You will actually do that. And easy par three, you know, you'll find a way you'll actually hit your ball onto the green for first time, and you'll make two putts in the hole. And then you just say, oh my God, I'm a golfer. Yeah. That's how it happens. First, you putt two putts on a green. Say, I can make two putts and get it and make it. So that's the first step. And then the second step is getting on a par three in one shot and making two putts. And then you realize, I can make par here. I can make par. And then the longer holes are, of course, more difficult. You have to learn to drive the ball farther and stuff. But you say, you know what? At least I can do this somewhat, you know. And it's fun. And you feel a little legitimate being out there. And it's so beautiful out there. And peaceful and beautiful. And just like, wow, a whole world disappears for you. All this trying to figure out what I need to do for everybody disappears for a while. Now, a man's okay when he knows what women want him to do, but when women don't not sure what they want him to do, then he's not okay. He's not okay. So getting to the golf course gets away from that, and you know, I'm putting my struggles out here, you know, but at least it's not as intense as at home, you know. And then they're having a nervous breakdown because this is all this indecision, you know. Yeah, so I may just notify people that you're coming to play golf with me. That's it. Don't talk to me otherwise. That's all there is to it here. you know, the bosses say you got to come play golf. So I got to. You know, I got no choice. You tell the wife, girlfriend, wife, and say, you know, hey, I got no choice. I got to go. It's a tournament. And I don't know any girlfriend or wife. If the boss says you got to go play golf in the tournament, I don't know anyone that says you can't go. No, they'll say, no, you got to go. You got to go. You got to go. For sure. Yeah, I said that to my wife. I said, I don't think I'm going to play. She says, what do you mean you're not going to play? I quit golf. She says, so what? This is a tournament. This is, you know, the boss of, you know, of the business, the business, you know, told you you got to come play golf with us. He didn't say, do you want to? He said, no, hey, you know, he said, hey, we got a golf tournament, you know. They looked at me and I said, well, what do you mean? Yeah, of course I'm in. You know, you don't say no. I mean, you're in. I'm in. So she said, what do you mean you're not going? I said, nah, I quit golf. I don't play this. No, 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 no. He said, no, 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 no. That's a tournament. This is business. You got to show your face there. You, of course you're going. What are you talking about? You're going. So I said, okay. So she insisted that I go, right? Of course. That's business. You know? So can't use that as an excuse, guys. Cannot use that as an excuse. Nah, my wife said I couldn't go. My girlfriend said I couldn't go. My significant other said I couldn't go. No. No, that's nonsense. Nonsense. That's just an excuse. You know, the boss is telling you, you know, you gotta come play golf. So, of course you gotta go play golf. And they'll be glad, you see, because they know that they're killing you. But they say, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do with the guy. You know, really. I mean, you know, we got to stop blaming women. We're not blaming. It's not a blame game. They're caught in between right now. Between, should I be the goddess or the guru? Which one? And they're really good at being the goddess. And they don't know if they'll be good at being the guru. But I'm saying, guys, for sure they will be. The WOW practice, everyone will be good at it. As soon as you prove to yourself that you can do this, then you are the guru. And of course, the guru is going to be great. Male or female, absolutely. So you just have to trust in me in this. That, yeah, the women that decide to be the guru of their own WOW practice, they're going to be great at it. Don't worry. So you don't need to worry about them. You know, you don't need to worry about them. And you need to worry about yourself, right? Yeah. So they know they're ambivalent. They say, so they don't know how to help you. So you got an opportunity to go play golf with Clarity Ross. Go. Do it. You know, they'll say, do it. And you don't need to be there to help them out. You know, they have to just make the decision themselves. You have to be the guru of your own practice. And by you deciding you're to do that, you'll help them out in that way. You know, and so they say, at least he isn't around so to mortify me, because I don't know what to tell him. And when he's around, I feel like I have to tell him something, and it's freaking me out. But if you're not around, they'll say, oh, good. Because I don't know what the heck to tell him right now, because I can't decide. And it's driving him crazy and destroying him, and I don't want that to happen. So it's causing me to feel even more guilty and more stressed out. So you see, just get away from that dynamic. They'll be happy that you've gotten away from that dynamic. They'll be happy for themselves and happy for you, actually. And if you're in a gay relationship, same thing. Get away from that gay relationship too for a while, right? Yeah. Get away from that, because the same dynamic is in that. Same dynamic. I can't decide whether I want to be the goddess or a guru. Right? It's the same thing. So, seeing it that way, you see, it's not about just heterosexual men. It's just about men, okay? Getting away from the relationship, okay? Getting away from that and giving them the space to decide whether they're going to be the goddess or the guru, and giving yourself the space, you know, to decide whether you're going to be the guru or going to serve the goddess. Are you going to say, you can't do both. It's one or the other. The guru doesn't serve the goddess, okay? The guru is above the goddess. And the guru doesn't need to be served by the goddess either. The guru is self-contained. The guru knows what they're doing. They don't need any goddess to tell them what to do. And you may say, well, what about Sri Sri Narayana? She's not any goddess. She's no goddess. She's just a little girl. She's there. I'm nobody. I'm just a little girl. I'm a silly little girl. That's all I am. I'm nobody's guru. She's even beyond the guru. I'm not a goddess, and I'm not even a guru. Neither one. And what she does is she empowers us to be the guru. Okay? So when you decide to be the guru, you're not going to, you don't need to serve any goddess. Beyond that, you've got to practice. Wow, just dissipated that sneeze. It was a strong one. Suddenly tried to get me there, but nope. So yeah, gay men are welcome, heterosexual men are welcome, but only as men to golf. You see, only as men to golf. So they're really neither. They're neither heterosexual nor gay, you see. There's something beyond that, where you're just a man deciding to be a guru. Okay? That's all. You're like a renunciate. I'm a renunciate. I've renounced relationships, actually. I'm just a man who is a guru of my own practice. That's all I am. Now I'm far enough along where I'm a spokesman now for the Dharma Kings for this. So I have the authority to invite other men who deciding to be gurus of their own practice to accept this, okay, and not, and get past this transitional danger time, actually. So even if, like, you're a scratch golfer, I'm the boss, and I'm saying we're playing best ball. playing best ball. How about that? Laying down the law. So we're not going to be keeping a handicap. We will not be trying to generate a handicap through this golf. We're just out there having a good time. You know, smashing it off the tee and it's scoring like crazy. We'll play best ball. We'll start out that way for sure. That's pretty amazing. Now, some guys, maybe they're scratch golfers. They want to prove what a great golfer they are. And I want to show you. No. You don't want to mortify me either, you see. So we'll all be humble here. I'm going to be humble too. Maybe this Pabasama gave you this. You know, the Tiger Woods of spirituality. You know, or not spirituality. The Tiger Woods of skillful means, you might say. Skillful means. Play best ball. So I'm there with Tiger Woods. And he says, oh, we're playing best ball today. I said, okay. And he might say on a drive, he says, well, we're playing your ball. It's a great drive. We're playing that one. I said, yeah, Tiger, yours was better. He said, no, that doesn't matter. We're playing yours. Yours was really good, too. Let's play from here. I like this one. Like that. You can always opt for that. So the host has final say on these issues. You know, the host has final say. You have to realize that. Someone has to have the final say to decide this. You know, what's the format? And what are the rules of the format? That's what golf is. There are rules, there are format, and someone's the authority. I mean, right? So if Tiger says that we're playing from your shot, that's how it is. So I think this will be a, you know, good challenge for you to play from your shot here, and let's both play from right here. I like this. Okay, you're the boss, and that's how it is. So I will establish the format, and I will establish the rules, you know, in best ball, and shall we play your shot or not? And because I have to monitor the overall mortification factor and humility factor and the overall feel of it all. I have to be the one that, you know, has to monitor that. How to build confidence. You know, how to build confidence is really important. Very, very important. Golf's tricky. You can gain it in an instant and lose it in an instant. Very tricky. So you really have to watch out for that. I was reading an excerpt from Tiger Woods' book, the 1997 Masters. It's out. I guess it came out March 13th or something. It's out now. And he said he went... The first nine holes in the Master Golf Tournament, he shot a 40, which was four over par. In other words, a horrible start for him, like the worst start ever. He said maybe he's never had such a bad start in a golf tournament. And he walked to the 10th tee, which is the back nine, and he said, as he walked from the 9th tee to the 10th tee, he remembered something. He says, just forget your last shot. It has no bearing on your next shot. No bearing at all. He's trained himself that way. Just to drop whatever shot you had before, it's completely gone. It has no bearing on your next shot. That's mental focus. He was super good at that. Super great mental focus. And so he got to the 10th tee, and he hit a two iron. And he had, for a warm-up for the Masters, he had played at his private course, Islesworth in Florida, and he shot a 59 there. He shot a 59. Which is just, you know, insanely great. That's just, it's a magical score. You go under 60, 59. It, for a long time, 59 was the lowest score ever shot in tournament golf. And but this is a private course, so it wasn't a tournament golf. But he shot a 59. In other words, he was playing like out of his mind great. So he gets to the Masters, he shoots a 40 on the front nine. And so he's going to the 10th, he went to the 10th hole, he hits it, so he hits his 2-iron. And he hits it just right. And he said, suddenly, he remembered, he says, my 2-iron swing from Islesworth. He suddenly remembered it, because at Islesworth, I guess he had a lot of 2-irons to shoot a 59. And he said, oh, that's my Islesworth swing. That's my 59 swing. I've got it. And from that point on, he, what did he end up, like 19 under par or something? 18 maybe? So, since he was 4 over par for the next 54 holes, no, less, 63 holes, I guess. He was 22 under par. Shot 22 under par. Because he ended up at 18 under, so he's 4 over the front nine. So, is that right? 18 AF, 54, 63. Yeah, 63. 18, 22 under par. And he said that just that one shot, everything clicked into place. That one shot, everything clicked into place. He remembered that swing, that feel, whatever it was. He says, oh, that's it. Poof. Rest is history. Pretty amazing. Of course, we don't have that 59 swing to go back to, do we? Not necessarily. So, you know, even Tiger can lose it, but you can get it back. He got it back just like that. But the problem is with golf is you can lose it just like that, too. And he had lost it there somehow. So, you have to, I have a lot of experience in this, 44 years. Is you really have to be careful on a golf course not to lose your confidence. Even when you hit a great shot, maybe you don't get to play that as the best ball. Because the problem is, when you hit a great shot and then after that you chunk your ball, you get really deflated. So it's better to put it in the bank. So let's say you hit a drive and you hit like 280 and it's like the best drive of your life. So, oh my God, finally I get to, I look at this. You know, I may hit a drive less than that. And I say, you know what? We're hitting for my drive on this one, not yours. So then when you chunk it, you're not ruining your good drive. You see that? You're not ruining your good drive. You still got the good drive in the bank. You still got those good memories in the bank. So I might even say we don't play from your best shots. You see that? How that works? That's like super Zen golfish type of thing, right? It's awesome to see that. Nothing is worse than setting yourself up, think, oh my God, I drive so great now, I'm going to go for birdie. And what do? You scull your ball, goes flying over the green into a lake or something, you know, and then you're just like cursing yourself and saying, I'm an idiot, I ruined my great drive, I'm so stupid. And then maybe the whole rest of the round of the golf, you're just down in the dumps, you know, you're just saying, I can't believe the best drive of my life, and then what did I do? I ruined it all. So we may play these rules, you know. It's my rules we're playing. And you may hit the best drive of your life. And I'm going to say, that's great. That's great. So we're going to put that in your memory banks of you can do that. And isn't that wonderful? But we're not going to let you ruin that memory. We're not going to let you ruin that memory. We'll hit from my ball. And if you ruin it, that's okay. You can ruin my great drive. I'm okay with that. At least I hope I am. See, it's not ruining my confidence if you hit it lousy. And if I hit a lousy shot, well, I just have to, you know, somehow I'll be able to deal with that maybe. And right now, I'm feeling like I can probably hit some pretty consistently good shots with this technique that Holy Spirit showed me. I'm not going to be hitting too many bad shots. Wow. This is amazing. I mean, this is like a revolution. It's revolutionary here. Because none of this stuff has ever occurred to me in 44 years of playing golf. None of this. Wow. Now, will we be drinking alcohol? No. Nothing against guys having a beer too, but this is serious business in terms of building your confidence up and the intensity of the wow intensity of it all. You have to face it alone. You can't have your buddy alcohol along with you, your buddy drugs along with you. You know, you cannot. No drugs, no pot, no alcohol, no drugs. I feel I can get you through it. I do. I feel confident that in flipping the script and playing it this way, I feel like we can do it this way. You can just say, well, you know, he's the boss. If someone asks you, well, he's the boss, and so, you know, play it the way the boss wants to play it. He makes his own rules, basically. That's right. As a Dharma spokesman, Dharma King spokesman, I make my own rules, depending on what the Dharma Kings tell me to do. They tell me what to do, and then I, you know, lay down the law. This is how we're going to do it. So it's about building up your confidence. And I learned a lesson. Last time I went to the driving range, it's kind of, they keep telling me, you got to get ready to play golf. I said, what are you talking about? Said, okay. Went to the driving range and hit 80, more than 80 shots. Maybe almost close, you know, maybe close to 100 almost. Just a pitching wedge. Just a pitching wedge. And what happened was, I started out terrible. And I said, oh my God, I'll never be able to fulfill my role, whatever it is. They want me to play golf, and I'm still horrible. And then I took my thumb and forefinger off the grip. Only used on the right hand, only these three fingers. First, I took just my index finger off, and I started hitting it a lot better. And then finally, I tried taking my thumb off, and I started hitting it really good. And so I hit 10 in a row, and every single one was the same. It was just like, boom, 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 like that. I said, wow, I've got it. This is amazing. And then I said, what do I do now? Now, in the past, I would have said, okay, I can hit my pitching wedge, great. So now I'm going to go hit my driver, because I got to work on that. I got to do this. But this time I said, no. I'm just going to keep hitting this pitching wedge. I'm going to build my confidence. So I hit like 100. I hit like maybe, from that point, maybe I hit like 50. At least 50 in a row. Great. 50 in a row. Boom, boom, boom. Just. And then I went to my 9. I got another bucket and went to my 9. And I struggled at first with that. And then I started dialing my nine in as well. And so I built confidence, but especially my pitching wedge. I built super confidence. I said, oh my gosh, I can't, I can do no wrong. I can do no wrong with this club. I can do no wrong with this club. And maybe I should have just stuck just with the pitching wedge. You know, I feel a little jitters with the 9 because I had some troubles with it. But I did dial that in too. I did dial it in. So I walked away hitting that rate too. So I could do no wrong. So it's the first time I've ever done that. So that built confidence in me. So I still have that confidence. So building confidence on a golf course is what's most important. It's not saying, well, let me take on this challenge or let me do this. No, it'll destroy you if you do that. So you have to keep, first and foremost in your mind is, how do I build confidence? And here's another example. Let's say, like, beginner gets their putt real close, and they say, oh, I made a great lag putt, that's great. Now, I'm going to build my confidence by making that short putt. And I may say, no. We're going to hit from my putt, which is farther away. We're not going to hit from yours. Why? Because if they miss that two-footer, once again, that's going to crush them. They said, I made this great lag putt, the best lag putt, a super putt, and then I missed this two-footer. What an idiot I am. I can't believe what an idiot I am. That's what happens. Whereas if you use my putt, you know, and you miss, it's like, oh, well, it wasn't my putt that we used, so I still have that good lag putt in my memory banks. That's not taken away from me. I didn't let that get taken away from me. So that's how you build confidence in yourself out there. Wow, this is Dharma King. It's got to come from the Parmesan, all this. The Dharma Kings. Because I never thought of this stuff before. I never would have thought of any of this before. This is like total inspiration. And it's just here now because I committed. I said, okay, let's move this forward quickly. I said, I don't know. And now they're moving it forward quickly. I didn't expect this at all. Not at all. This is wisdom beyond my expectations. So I'm temporarily knocked out by it, actually. I got to wow this. So this is causing me the burn now. This is just, yeah, I'm really hit by the wow now. Full stop in the wow. For me, this is just like a huge revelation, all this. It's like life-changing. Actually, so I feel my whole life has just been changed. So that's enough. That's enough. Okay, I'm struck by my whole life has just changed. So, you know, I'm just gonna. We'll talk about the weather at this point. How do I feel? I feel wow. What am I going to do? I'm going to do wow. What's next? Wow. What's my reaction to this? Wow. How do I explain it? Wow. What am I going to take away from this? Wow. What am I going to remember about this? Wow. What am I going to do about it? Wow. It's 1:01. My watch, yeah. Oh, what time is it? It's wow. How do I feel? I feel wow. This has literally just changed my whole life. Literally, I can feel it. So, of course, I'm. It's just wow, is what it is. I am wow. What am I? I'm wow. What's my life now? Wow. What am I going to do? Wow. That's what I'm going to do. Wow. What are my expectations? Wow. So, when you feel like this, you don't try and do anything, really. In that, you're committed to no action at all. Just wow. Because I feel really, you feel kind of just like a rag doll. I mean, just like, ah, I guess, I don't know what, you know. My whole life has just completely changed. I mean, I don't know what to do. Well, I know to do nothing. That's what I know to do. You know, to do just wow. I'll just do just wow is what I'm doing. That's all. Just wow. You can say that. Committed to just wow. And you see that deep breath comes to you. It comes of its own volition. You know, you don't automatically take a deep breath. But at some point you'll just feel this release and you're just like, oh yeah, I'm okay. I'll be okay because I wowed it. You see, I feel like now I'm gonna be okay. For a minute there, shock. You have to block the panic. I mean, I practice the wow every single day, almost all day. So, I'm good at it. That doesn't mean that it's not a struggle, of course. I mean, I really have to do it. But results come pretty quickly for me. Now, the results may not come so quickly for you like that. You may have to really hang in there for a while. But, you know, I mean, you've seen in some of my videos, I hang in there for an hour or so. I mean, just, and then, but eventually, you'll suddenly feel, I'm going to be okay. That's sort of the feeling, I'm going to be okay. And then you realize, wow, my life has just changed, and I'm going to be okay. It's all okay. I'm going to be okay. That's now how I feel. I sort of realize the panic's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. But for a while there, I had to really block the panic. Serious business. There's nothing like success hitting you to make you panic. At first, it puts you into shock and then panic. So, the greatest danger we have is success, but we want success. We have to be successful, but it's a great danger to us. So that's why this wow practice is super important. Super important. Everyone ultimately has to do it, meaning you have to block the panic of your success. The shock will be there for sure. Oh my gosh, my whole life just completely changed in an instant, just like quickly changed. Wow. So don't agonize over it. Go right into the wow practice. I say, well, how's my life going to be then? It's going to be wow. What am I going to do? I'm going to do wow. How am I going to feel? I'm going to feel wow. How will others feel? Wow. Where will I be? I'll be wow. I'll be in wow is where I'll be. And what will I be doing? I'll be doing wow. Okay. Great. So, you see this blocks the panic because you're stating, you know what you're going to be doing. You know what to expect, which is wow. So when you know what your expectations are, then you say, you're going to feel I'm going to be okay. And that blocks the panic. So I'm being the guru of my own path here, right? This is the guru of my own path. And you have to be the guru of your path. Dharma King, spokesman and host. Okay. My guru. My guru. You're the guru of your own path. But I'm the boss of the rest of it, so to speak, you might say, spokesman. So I can play that role, but you're still the guru of your path, not me, not me. Your practice is the highest, it's even higher than the Dharma King's, your practice. And when you're guru of your practice, that's the highest. But in other areas, you let the Dharma Kings, you know, set some parameters for you. Set parameters. You don't worry about that. You're focused on being the guru of your own practice, of your own success, experiencing the success, and then experiencing the success of blocking the panic that can grow out of the shock of that success. Because you just change your life, you know. When you practice, your life just St. Paul said, I die every day, meaning I've got a new life every day. That's true. This is what I've experienced for a long time now. Every day, I woke up this morning, so much clarity. It was like a new life for me, actually. I realized I have a new life today. It's that different. I'm so far, much further along. I now saw, not only did I see what death is, I saw what dissolution. So you have a corpse. I saw what that's all about. And this morning, I saw what the decay of that corpse is all about. Yeah, you talk about changing my life. Talk about that. I mean, you want something profound. Not only have I seen through death previously, but now this morning I saw through dissolution, decay, all of it. I know what that is all about now too. So, you know, that's like a new life, right? Radically changed my life. Puts me in a whole different, you know, echelon to see that. So, but every day's like that for me. Every day, my life changes drastically. My success is drastically more than I expected. And so that really radically changes my life. So it's like a new life. So I die every day and am reborn in Christ, as St. Paul said, meaning reborn in a new life. As the guru of my path, I'm now aware, I really am the guru here. Wow. That's guru insight there. That's guru life. You see through death and impermanence, dissolution, both, simply. That's very much a guru-ness, super guru-ness, actually. And so, wow, changed my life. So that's how it is. Success changes your life. Your expectations change radically. You say, no, I can do this. Before, you said, I can't do this. So your life was built around the belief, expectations that you can't do this. So you have this nice, comfortable life based on this. Well, I can't do that, so I know what to do because I won't be doing that. But now you suddenly see, I can do this. So your whole life based on believing, expecting that you won't do this because you can't do it, gone. It's dead. Gone. And so now you have to have an entirely new set of expectations based on that you can do this and you will be doing this. So now your expectations of a life will be built around that you can do this and will be doing it. So this is a, you know, it's like a new life, like you're born again. I'm born again every day, actually. You know, Christians say that they've been born again, but what really happens for all of us, not just Christians, ultimately, is you've discovered the principle of being born again. And and what you should be doing is doing it every day. So what happens when Christians say, my God, I had this experience with Jesus or God, and I've been born again. What they realize is they can be the guru of their own path. The WOW practice, their own practice, actually. It's not really a path, it's a practice. And they discovered that they really can do this. They really can succeed in getting back to God. And that totally changes their expectations. Before, they didn't think they could do it. They were an alcoholic, they were addicted to this, they were a terrible person, and suddenly they discover that they can actually do this practice. They can get a glimpse of God. Totally changes their life. Okay. But that's just the beginning. So being born again is just the first step. But it's the all-important first step is to prove to yourself that you can be the guru. You can do this. You can be the guru of your own practice. You can do it. Then you start doing it, working towards every day. You start having breakthroughs. Or at least you're trending in that direction. You do it again and again and again and again. And then like St. Paul, he says, I die daily. So St. Paul was the guru of his own path. In other words, in the way back to God, calls it Christ, in Christ, you die daily. That's what you have to do to be a quote-unquote Christian, which is just one who's on the journey home, a pilgrim making the journey back home. To no profundity at all, no spirituality at all, but just, it's just, nothing can be said about it, right? Yeah. Reality, the way that it is. Give up our, reality the way it is. You need to trend towards dying daily. That is the practice for all of us, not just Christians, for everyone. That's just a set of labels that's being used. Religions are just a set of labels that are being used. But really, the practice is all the same. You die daily to your expectations. So the reason I'm a Dharma prince is because I've actually become very, very skillful at this practice, with insight into it, why it's so effective, and been able to see the big picture of it all. Okay, so that's why I've been given these responsibilities and help. Now, there are others who have caught glimpses, and they said, "Well, I'm the guru of my path." Yes, absolutely. So I'm there to encourage you to keep being the guru of your path. But they think they've got it. No, they just had some success, and for a moment they'd stepped out of spirituality. But really, ultimately, we have to step out of spiritual. We have to lose interest in all spirituality. So they had experience of losing interest, stepping beyond spirituality. And then they say, okay, now how can I make this spiritual? And they write books and try to tell people about this. No, that's not it. That's not it. So I'm way, way, way more advanced than that. But they don't necessarily see that. Because I've gotten past, most spirituality. A lot of it. That's why Lampchump has said, you better start considering being a Dharma prince. Because you're really far along. I didn't know that. He knew it. I didn't know it. See, I'm working so hard, I don't evaluate where I'm at. Just every day, I just work to die daily to my expectations, push through that wall, and that's all I do. That's all I've done. My whole life, that's all I've done. So I don't know how far along I am. I'm not keeping track of it. I have no idea. But Longjempa, coming into my life, indicated something to me. It's like, wow, why is he coming into my life like that, treating me this way? Why did Jamie and Kenzie Choki Lodo treat me the way he treated me? I was shocked by it. I said, what the heck, because I don't know. Then he said, I advise you, you know, to consider, my advice to you is consider perhaps being a Dharma prince. Do you want to be a Dharma prince? Consider that. And I said, well, okay, I'll consider it, but I don't know why, you know, but I'll give it, consider it. And so, you know, I've been considering it. So, see, the Dharma kings know how far along we are. We don't. We don't, because we're just working on, you know, desperately trying to, you know, wow our success and not panic and keep working on it. And, you know, and at least, you know, for me, it's just like, I got no time to write a book. I mean, if I write a book, then tomorrow it'll be irrelevant because I just died to all that. And now I have a completely new perspective. I have way more success. So how the heck am I going to write a book? It's ridiculous. I can't write a book. Literally, I mean, I can't write a book because tomorrow I'll see everything so much better. You know, there's no doubt about it. That's my experience. I die. I have a new life every day now. So, okay, how can I write a book? So, but the Dharma kings, they know how far along we are towards losing interest in spirituality, which is what we have to do, ultimately. And so Longchenpa knew that I was, trending in the right direction, and I had gotten a lot of work done on this. But I didn't know that. As far as I knew, I hadn't gone anywhere. You know, I mean, I get up in the morning, I say, well, you know, I have to take it like I've really not even advanced in the slightest bit, so I better work like crazy today to try and at least take the first step. That's always my attitude. I haven't done anything. So I just keep this attitude. I still keep it. You know, just try to keep this, but I have to. He said you need to start realizing that you actually have gotten very far along. And I don't like that. So, you know, that might compromise my efforts, but it hasn't. I still put full effort into it every day. But I have to take on some responsibility to help out others now, is what he's saying. And he said, you're capable of doing that if you want to, you know. I said, well, okay, let's see if that's possible. Let's see if it's possible, and I'll keep working. So Dharma Prince is only a Dharma king can make a Dharma prince, can tell you. I can't tell anybody they're a Dharma prince. That's not my role. But I can, you know, say that I am one because the Dharma kings have told me that I am. And, you know, to say that I'm not would mean that they're a liar. They don't know what they're talking about. So that means I am far along. And obviously, you know, to see through death and then impermanence and dissolution, and just, it's so simple, it's just so, you know, just seeing it wholly, with whole mind, not, I see this as something I need to explain to someone, no. It's just simply apparent to me, obvious, it's just simply obvious, that's all. Simply obvious. There's nothing more to say about it. It's that easy. It's just simply obvious. You know, that, you know, has to be far along. You know, it's pretty hard to say it, you know, argue that it's not. I don't really have any arguments. I can't go along jump and say, no. I mean, it's like, I'm like, you know, busted, you know. I've been outed. You know. But, I still don't feel like I'm far along. But I have to admit that most likely I am. You know, there's no reason, I can't reasonably say I'm not. So it means I have to take on some responsibility. So, I mean, writing books for people is just is form of therapy. That's okay. That's okay. I just did videos. Okay, but I didn't want to put it in the form of a book. The people have this book, you know, they're reading it. Videos are much more abstract and fluid, and we're on to the next one, right? Whereas if you have a book, it's a major undertaking. It's been set in stone in a certain way, culturally. These videos are not set in stone culturally, really. Every day is it, you know, it's a different perspective, right? It's just an experiencing we're having. So I'm much more comfortable with that than trying to put anything in writing or in stone or book, you know, no. That can stall you out badly. It's a very dangerous thing to do, because then you start attracting devotees. Oh, look at that, it's very spiritual. You wrote this book. Oh, you know, then you start, you know, holding seminars about the book, and before you know it, you know, you're Mr. or Mrs. Spirituality. Bad move. Bad move. But it can, I mean, in self-publishing now with Kindle or whatever, it's less dangerous than it used to be. Okay. It's less dangerous because everybody can just publish. Anybody can just sit down. I can publish every day. I could write a book every day, really. Book a day. I do a video a day, right? Book a day, and with on Kindle, right? You just do it in like a, you know, your word processing program, format it for in PDF or in Kindle the way it's supposed to be formatted, and you know, if you once you get used to it, publish it, self-publish it for free. On Amazon Kindle, and you're now, you know, an author. Or you get a doctorate in metaphysics from somewhere, and you can call yourself doctor. So I'm now Doctor So and So, and I've written, you know, I've published, you know, four different books. And then the spirituality folks will say, "Wow, I think I found someone to dance with. I think I found my dance partner. Let's do the dance of spirituality. I'll be your goddess." Or I'll be your god, and you'll be my god, and I'll be your goddess, and we'll do the spirituality dance. And then, you know, welcome to hell. But you don't have to do that. I mean, you can publish to Kindle, and you and just as a therapy. I mean, write, but you can publish to a blog too. So I mean, I don't know why you need to put it in a book form. I think that's getting pretty dangerous when you do that. I mean, a lot of people have blogs, which is fine. This is like a video blog. Okay, that's much safer, much safer. You want to, you can delete at any time. But if you actually publish a book out there. And you'd be known as an author. You know, how do you delete that? I mean, I guess Kindle, you could go back and delete it. Yeah. So, you know, but it's a step that I didn't want to take. I felt it was a very dangerous step to take. If someone says, "Well, you said this in the video," I said, "Well, so what? You know, it's just a video blog I'm doing. Today I'm blogging this. This is what I'm saying now. I don't care what I said. I don't hold myself to anything I said in the past at all. This is a new life. That was many lives ago, actually. Like every video is a different life. So I'm just showing you what's possible. You can do a video blog or a blog, but I would suggest don't be, you know, stop short of being a book publisher. That's getting into dangerous territory. It's so dangerous, I won't do it. It's like drugs, you know. If you do drugs, at some point you're gonna have to draw the line. That's the problem with drugs, you see. It really is. Dion Amici in his witnessing about drugs, you know, beautiful witnessing about it. It was tremendous, very honest, and accurate. He told the truth. And it says drugs are a very slippery slope. You say, well, I can handle this. You know, this isn't so bad. People said I'd have trouble with drugs, and I'm not having trouble with drugs. You think you're smoking pot? No, nah, it's just fine. It's just recreational. I'm having, you know, it's like that. And then, and then someone offers you cocaine, and you say, oh no, you know, and the pusher says, you know what? It's just a drug. That's all. And didn't people tell you couldn't handle pot? And look how well you're handling it. You know, it's not a problem for you, right? And you say, no, not really. I mean, you know, sometimes, you know, it's paranoid and, you know, but it's really, I think I'm handling it pretty well. You know, all things considered, I'm handling it pretty well. And they say, well, you see? So these people say, don't start using cocaine. It's the same stupid, they say that's the same stupid argument they have. They're idiots, right? Weren't they wrong about pot for you? They're so stupid, you know, telling you shouldn't do it. So it's the same thing with cocaine. You know, just try it. See what you think. That's all. Just try it once. And then you'll see that you handle it, you know, fine. And so you start thinking, huh. Yeah. Yeah, maybe I should just try it once. Just try a little bit once. That's all. And you'll see if you're handling it. You had no problem. You're handling it fine. Of course, what they're not telling you is they're desperate for you to be a cocaine addict like they are, to try to help them out, because they're not handling it well at all. And it's the same thing with people getting to smoke pot. They're actually desperate to get you to be their pot smoking friend to help them handle it, because they're not handling it well at all either. That's the insidious lie of all drugs. Nobody handles drugs well. Nobody does. They just want you to be their friend, fellow addict, to help them handle it well, because they're not. But the problem is, now you have two people who are not handling it well. That's what happens. And then you say, you need a third. And so you try to say, well, let's get them in too. Maybe we get more. And so the drugs always expand, and you want to get more and more people into it that way. So you don't feel that maybe I'm not the only one who's mishandling it. You know, they're not handling it well either. And you know, you look at someone, and they're like messing it, really not handling it well. And you kind of laugh and say, huh, look at that, what idiots. They're not, you know, I'm handling it better than they are, kind of thing. So you get in this competitive thing. Drugs are very competitive of who's handling it best. It's really a terrible scene, drugs, terrible. And Dion realized this. Those who realized it, they get out of it. He said, man, this is terrible. I got to get out of this. I don't know how to get out of it. And I didn't know this, but apparently he got help, like a 12-step program for drug addiction. And but he had this moment where apparently he says that God freed him of it. I mean, he freed him of it somehow. But also he did the 12-step. I'm not sure exactly how the witnessing goes. But anyway, his honesty about the drugs is very accurate. So you got a celebrity, really maybe the best singer of the world, you know, one of the best singers in the history of the world, really. Dion really is that good. I mean, I'm very sharp when it comes to singing. And he's just got it. You know, he's absolutely got it. I mean, he was so good that really his record label and everybody said, drop the Belmonts. Said, Dion, you got to have a solo career. I mean, you're that good. We don't even need the Belmonts behind you. It's kind of getting in the way of how great you are. So he dropped the Belmonts after about a year and a half. I think that Belmonts did Where or When, I Wonder Why. And Why Must I Be a Teenager, you know, in Love, Teenager in Love. I think those are the hits that he did with the Belmonts. He had several big mega hits with the Belmonts. Then they dropped the Belmonts and went solo. You know, Dion, what, By Myself or All Alone or something like that. There's an album. He had an album, and he had this female backup singers doing the backup. And he had the hit Lonely Teenager, which is an unbelievably great song. Different sound than the Belmonts. So there's a contrast there. with the female backup singers, and that was their best song, and it sounds fabulous. I wish he'd, well, he did some of both, so he already did, yeah. And then that stalled out, and then they decided that he wanted to try this more rock and roll sound, kind of a more up-tempo sound than the Belmonts. And so he hired the Del Satins. His record label did, said, "Let's bring in the Del Satins to back you up." And then that's when the hits started. First one was "Run Around Sue," which went to number one. Second was "The Wanderer," which went to like number three or two or three. And then the hits just, just nonstop hits. The Majestic, "Drip Drop" came along later. Little Diane. "Love Came to Me," Donna the Prima Donna, Ruby Baby, and ultimately the final solo hit later with Abraham Martin and John was his final big hit. But he had this string of hits with the Del Satins. Oh, Sandy, "This Little Girl," all of those were from the Del Satins, which was more of an up-tempo kind of thing. He threw his like saxophone voice in there, and it's like, wow. I mean, that really. I read this blog, read this on the line by this aficionado of doo-wop, who lived in New York in the Bronx during all this, and so he gave a first-person account of what happened. That was really interesting. He said, "Man, Dion the Belmonts just hit so hard. I wonder why. I wonder why. Love me so." He said that came out and it just hit like dynamite. I mean, everyone, you heard it everywhere you went as you walked through Little Italy and the Bronx and everywhere, all these tenement buildings. You heard that play on the radio coming out from the record player. They had the 45 singles and on car radios. It was everywhere. And it was just very, very, very giddy, amazing experience. Dion the Belmonts just hit New York like a storm. With "I Wonder Why," I think was the first one that really hit. "Wonder Why You Love Me So." "Could it be? Is it because?" Dun, 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 dun. Yeah. Very nice song. Then they hit with another one, "Where or When," which is a slow ballad, but that also was tremendously big. I think it went almost to number one, I think. It was a huge song, "Where or When." And so they were just, I mean, they could do no wrong. They were just instant kings of New York, Dion and the Belmonts. And then he dropped them and did the "Lonely Teenager," which was a big hit. And then came "Run Around Sue," and "Run Around Sue" hit the whole country like a storm. And Dion just blew up then. At that point, he was just a king. I mean, the New Yorkers, especially in the Bronx where he lived, I mean, they were so proud of him. One of us has made it, is at the top. And they just felt so proud of him. He was the king of New York streets. Because in Little Italy, the tenement, I mean, people just were slaving away to survive. You worked in a garment factory or something. You were a gang or a gangster or something. I mean, nobody was a big shot in Little Italy, not a real bit, but Dion was a legitimate superstar, big shot, and he made it, and they all knew it. And man, when he walked down the street, it's like, there goes Dion. There goes the king of the New York streets. That's how. So no wonder why he was so confident. I mean, he was it. I mean, that's a heady trip to be on, right? I mean, I don't know if anybody's really had an experience quite like that, where you're in this huge city, New York, and you're part of the, just the kind of a little, almost like a ghetto like thing. I mean, and you are the king. He was the king. Everybody knew it, you know? I mean, and they just loved it, you know? Just loved it. So this guy's singing about our place, what we experience, what we feel, what we're going through. And he's singing it like nobody else can sing it. And he's put out this music that nobody else, and he's going to number one in the country. And we're somebody now, you know? Somebody's listening to our story in song. And Dion did it for us. And so that was a big, big deal. I mean, they felt tremendous pride. They still do. Tremendous pride in that, you know? They're very prideful kind of people there. So, yeah, he's still the king to them, you know? But yeah, I mean, listening to that music, I say, holy cow. I mean, has there ever been better music made? I don't know. I mean, for that time, for that, everything clicked properly. It's like the Beach Boys, you know. Everything clicked properly. And they were the pride of Southern California, the Beach Boys. Similar kind of thing with Brian Wilson. You know, he was the king. He was the king down there in SoCal. So, similar. But, you know, he, of course, got addicted to drugs too. Couldn't handle it. Dion got addicted to heroin. But both of them, Beach Boys and Dion, with Belmont's backed up by the female backup, one album, female backup singers, and then the Del Saddens. I don't know the name of the female backup singers. I've been searching and researching. No, I can't find it anywhere on the internet. I cannot find it. Otherwise, I'd tell you who they were, because they were fabulous. They were fabulous. But the Del Saddens were really, really good. I mean, they're just great. You got to put them in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I mean, they're as good as the Beach Boy backup vocals, or better. I don't know. I mean, how do you six of one, half a dozen of the other? I mean, they're just fabulously great. And Dion's a better singer than Brian Wilson or Mike Love by a long shot. The difference with the Beach Boys is Brian Wilson's surreal voice. The high voice that he had was just, nobody ever sung like that before or after. So it gave a different sound to the Beach Boys. Whereas if Dion would have had that sound in his backup or something, then he would have just blown everything out of the water. But by the way it is, it's just, you know, they're equal, six of one, half a dozen of the other, Beach Boys and Dion, really. They're equivalent. But Dion's a way better singer than any of the Beach Boys. Way better singer. But the Beach Boys had this flavor. Better flavor overall with Brian Wilson's, you know, the high notes, and the way they were used to, they able to structure their harmonies, and it, with that highness to it, it gave a really compelling, piercing, compelling sound. There's a different feeling to the sound than the Del Satins. But as far as talent goes, the Del Satins, I think, were just as talented in their harmonies as the Beach Boys, really. They're just as talented. They were so creative, and just did a perfect job. What can you say? And no, almost nobody even knows this. They think it's Dion and the Belmonts. It's crazy. It's amazing. They didn't get credited on any of the records. So everybody still refers to Dion and the Belmonts, and they think that the Belmonts did all these songs. Now, the Belmonts had, like I said, about, you know, three or four hits. Three, I think three big ones. Starting off, I Wonder Why. I think they might have When You Wish Upon a Star. Was that Dion and the Belmonts too? That wasn't really a hit, but it's a good song. I mean, they did some really good songs, but nothing like Run Around Sue. I mean, when you hear Run Around Sue, it's just holy cow. It just went through the stratosphere with that. I mean, that was like a major shift. That song just hit like thunder. I think that was 1961 or something that came out. Unfortunately, that developed into rock and roll, and, you know, there's more up tempo and more, you know, raunchy kind of sound, sort of saxophone sound voice. That was the times, and it really propelled the whole thing forward in more up tempo, up temponess. I like the Belmont sound. You know, I really do. The softer, more mellow, sweeter sound is beautiful. The Del Satins was much more up-tempo, but the talent was, you know, it was amazing how they put that together. From a musical standpoint, it's a high watermark. And then from there, off and running, The Wanderer came out. Holy cow. You know, tour de force, vocal tour de force, those songs, The Wanderer. I call it his saxophone voice. It's got this rasp to it. You know, how he did that and not, you know, burn his voice out, man, is extraordinary. Because it's just, he was able to put this natural push on his voice, turn it sort of a saxophony like sound to it. And of course, he had the saxophone in the background there, pushing the rock. The rock and roll sound was, saxophone was a big part of rock and roll in the early days, actually. Even the solos were done by saxophones, right? You know, in The Wanderer, I believe it's a saxophone doing the solo. But man, that voice on The Wanderer, you hear, you just, what the heck, you know? What? Who is that? What? I don't think we ever heard anybody sing like that before. I think that came out in 62. Donna the Prima Donna came out in 63. Yeah, and that's, I don't know, maybe that's his best, best singing, you know, just amazing. The whole song is amazing. You know, it's Dion at his ultimate, Donna the Prima Donna. 1963, I believe the same year that I Get Around came out by the Beach Boys, which is, you know, they're at their best. I Get Around, just, you could, the whole thing is there. It's very, you know, changed the whole music sensibilities. I Get Around, around, you know, what? I heard that, I said, what? What is this? That even knocked Donna the Prima Donna out, you know? It was just like so different. The wrists they used, you know, they used, I believe they used the Wrecking Crew on that. The way the song is structured, it's like, what in the world is that? And then the high harmonies and everything, it just knocked me out when I heard it. Because I was listening to radio, transistor radio then when I was 7 years old, 63. And so I heard Donna the Prima Donna. I was aware of these songs. And I said, well, this is good stuff. But I remembered very distinctly for the first time hearing I Get Around came out. When it came out, it was June something, or in 1963. It was in the backyard. And I had the transistor radio on. And that song came on. And I just stopped. Just stopped dead in my tracks. And I said, what is that? So at that point, that's when I got re-addicted to music, unfortunately. It would have been better if that had never happened. But it was destined to happen, right? So what can I say? That was the beginning of hell for me, because I got re-interested in music. Up until that point, I said, yeah, that's good stuff. I can do that. I see what's going on. Yeah, that's really great. That's nice music. But it was just nice music. And I was focused on spirit, you know, is focused on just awareness, natural awareness. But when I heard I Get Around, I said, what the heck is that? What are they doing there? What in the world? It threw me for a loop, you know? Musically, it challenged me musically. I said, wait a minute. I'd never heard that before. What is this? So musically, the Beach Boys were more advanced than anybody. Right? What? I said, that's genius. I said, that is pure genius, man. Wow. I want to hear some more of this. So then I I got into the beach voice. And then from there, from then, I started getting into Chuck Berry and rock and roll. I was really into Chuck Berry. I started practicing guitar and learned all his songs. Oh, Maybelline, you know, why can't you be true? You done gone back doing the things you used to do, which is what I was doing. I was going back to music. I kept playing that song. I said, uh-oh, something ain't right here. You done gone back doing the things you used to do. What's the matter? Why can't you be true, Maybelline? All right? And Chuck Berry was very compelling. He just passed away. And he really ruined me, you know. I mean, he really pushed me into the wrong direction, actually, with his music. Because once you got into rock and roll, got interested, then his music was very compelling. Sweet Little 16, Johnny B. Good, Maybelline, rock and roll music, on and on and on. Open the books, da-da-da-da-da-da. The teacher is teaching the golden rule, da-da-da-da. American history and practical math. You practice them hard, hoping to pass, you know. Ring, ring goes the bell. The teacher is talking, that song. And he's like these very jaunty, compelling rock and roll sort of things. And I learned how to play all those on the guitar, and then on and on. It just never ended. And then it went worse and worse and worse, and bad and bad and bad, spiraling down away from what I was supposed to be doing, which is be the guru of my own spiritual practice. And then everything piled on top of that. So music is like drugs, is a very slippery slope. Like I said, with drugs, I explained it to you, right? And music is the same way. Very slippery slope. Stick with what you know. Don't try to innovate anymore. We're not interested in innovation so much anymore, right? We're losing interest in all of the world. We're not trying to spiritualize the world. We're losing interest in the world, including a spiritualized world. I have no interest in a spiritualized world. No interest in that, really. No. Oh, but we can make heaven on earth. We can make a spiritualized world. I have no interest in that whatsoever. Who is it that's experiencing the spiritualized world? That's the question. I'm interested in that. Who is it? Is there some entity experiencing it? What's making it happen? So there's someone making the spiritualized world? Really? I don't want to be that person, that one making a spiritualized world. I'm beyond that. There's nothing at all you can say about what I am. I don't want to be something that something can be said about. I am freedom itself. I am freedom itself. Spiritualized world is hell. That's hell. And we'll all be, you know, gods and goddesses. That's hell. That's hell. For us, what we are, what we truly are, that's absolute hell. Okay? For a spiritualized world, that's hell. A reduced intensity zone is different than a spiritualized world. It's different. It's how you're getting free of a spiritualized world. It's you're realizing your freedom. You're free. You're freedom itself. There aren't any worlds. Because if there's a world, there has to be a maker of a world. And then where's your freedom? I don't want to be a maker of any worlds. Or any universes. That's hell. Christians sort of not as Christians as they used to be. Because the problem with Christianity or any religion is you get lazy, you stall out, you think you got it. But you can't do that. Religion is just a path. It's not a destination. And as soon as you make it turn into a destination, you stall out, and ultimately you'll fall away from it. You have to keep dying daily. You have to be the guru. Not Jesus the guru. So you turn Jesus into a guru, you stall out, because then it's a destination. You think you found your destination. This is not true at all. Forget about Jesus. You're the guru. You're the guru of your path. You have to die daily. You have to be the guru of your practice. So, ultimately, Christians stall out in certain ways. Maybe Dion went back to being Catholic, for instance, where, you know, you have the Jesus is now the guru entirely, and there's all these other gurus, the Pope and the priest, they're the gurus. That's a stall out. That's a stall out. Because Protestantism puts more pressure on you to be the guru, so to speak. It puts more pressure on you. It's like you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and that's where it's at. And so you have to really apply yourself more intensely to this personal relationship you now have with Jesus Christ. Okay, so that puts more pressure on you. Absolutely it does. When you want to be lazy, you can be a Catholic. Because the Pope and the priest, they do that for you. Don't worry about it. Just attend Mass, take the Eucharist, and you're good. And, you know, say a homily, and read something in the Bible, and people are like, you know, it's dozing off. Ah, priest, that's okay. You know, I know it's kind of boring, folks, but we're doing it for you. Don't worry. We're the guru of your path. Okay. But to be a Christian, to be, you know, what we call Christian, a Protestant Christian, is no, you've got a living relationship with Jesus Christ, and he's demanding that you live up to that, relate with him today. Right now. There's nobody between you and Jesus Christ. You gotta be for you relate with him. Okay? This puts the pressure on you. So that's why Christians tend to be much more active. You know, they're struggling with this personal relationship with Jesus Christ, which is what they're supposed to be doing. But they can stall out too, because it's they still are saying, no, but Jesus, you're they still want to, you know, deify him. They don't quite want to be the guru of their own path, but they're trending in that direction. They're bargaining with Jesus. Christianity is a bargaining process with Jesus. And at some point, you have to realize there are no bargains with Jesus. Jesus is calling you to be the guru of your own practice. That's his bargain. But it's no bargain, is it? No deal. It's the deal of no deal. Jesus makes you the deal of no deal. So from being a Christian, then you need to go into actual practice, where you actually start succeeding. You start flattening out profundity. You even flatten out Jesus. The profundity of Jesus is what? Is wow. Jesus is what? Wow. Jesus is just wow. The same as this fish is wow. Same as this bird is wow. Same as the sky is wow. Same as this plant is wow. Everything is just wow. And Christians have a hard time doing that. When they start doing that, then they get what's called spirituality is the next step. They get spirituality. But that's still an attempt to make a deal. It's still a deal. It's still, they have a little bit of a success and then in the path, and then when they stall out on that, then they get what's spirituality. And that's still trying to make a deal with Jesus. Saying, Jesus, you be Jesus, now I'll be spiritual. Okay. You'll be this profound savior, and I'll just be the spiritual goddess for you. You know, that's a stall out. That's a stall out. You stopped at that point. So you have to get this wow practice. Doesn't give you anywhere to go except practice. doesn't give you anywhere to go except practice. Just wow. Die, and as you do this, automatically clarity will arise in you, and you'll die to what you were yesterday. When you do the wow practice, this is what happens. You die every day, which is stressful. Now, if you stall out in the wild practice, you might become some super spiritual, someone super, super spiritual. Okay, but we don't want that either. That's still a deal. That's still a stall out. That's still a stall out. You don't ultimately succeed until you're like Ram Maharshi. Okay, so until then, you know, keep dying to what you are. Keep practicing the wow. And if the Dharma kings tap you on the shoulder and say, okay, you can help us out, then help them out. But don't you think that you can do that. You see, it's when you stall out on the wow practice, it's when you think that you are so advanced that you can now be a guru to others, you know, like that. That's a stall out. Only the Dharma kings know if you're, how advanced you are. So, for me, I just refused to do that. I just said, no, I'm not ready for anything like that, and I'm just going to keep dying to what I was yesterday. If I was a guru yesterday, today I'm dead to that. Okay? Like that. And so the Dharma king said, okay, you can help out some. Not me, I didn't say that. So that's why I put the Dharma kings, you know, they are above me, and I do, you know, I'm just a spokesman for them. I'm not a guru, I'm a spokesman. Because they're the ones that said that, not me. I never say I'm a guru or a teacher or anything like that. I'm just the guru of my own practice, but that's it. Yes, I'm the guru of my own practice, but I'm not. That's it. You have to be the guru of your practice. Very, very simple, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, well, kind of chilly today. We haven't reached, this is the last blast of winter for now. Today and then tomorrow it's going to clear up but still be cold because it's after the rain came. There's supposed to be some rain come through today, Sunday, and then clearing up tomorrow and cool, and then the temperature is going to start spiking, and then we're going to go back to, you know, the 70s, get up in the 70s, clear 70s, spring will be here. We got another little chance of cloudiness maybe Thursday, and then back to the sun. So this is like the last kind of feel, has sort of feel like winter to it still a little bit. But after this, I feel like, you know, we're getting close to April, right? And once we get into April, it's going to be springtime. So say goodbye to winter. We're saying goodbye to winter. Goodbye, winter. Thank you, winter. It was the most amazing winter ever, actually. The most amazing, wonderful winter ever, where you busted the drought in California. Gave us a November at the beach for me of waves that was just beyond. It was so wowish, you know. It was just, you know, unforgettable. Unforgettable November I had with the storms that you sent in here. And it's just, I mean, Thanksgiving at the ocean was just, you know, I just hoped it would never end. It was so beautiful. It was so amazing. Wow. What a day Thanksgiving was for last Thanksgiving. Dawn, warm, no wind, still and warm, with this glassy, unbelievably huge surf. And just so beautiful. Everybody just wandering around with a smile on their face. You know, it was just amazing. I was just hanging out there taping it all, and just people just like, wow, we're so happy. You do whatever you want. It doesn't, nothing bothers us today. It's like that. And then the Holy Spirit told me, okay, it's over with. And you know what? There hasn't been a, since I stopped going to the beach, there hasn't been a good day since. Not one. Not even one. I looked up, nothing really good. And they told me it's finished. And isn't that amazing? They knew it was finished. Haven't gone back since. They said, you got to turn your attention to something else, which is golf. And they were right. They knew. It was tough. It was really tough. Because I had this November, which was just, you know, this treat they gave me that just blew my mind so much. You know? I'll never be another November like that. Well, maybe there will. Maybe it'll be better, actually. Maybe there'll be something even better. I'm sure there will be even better coming along. But that really was so extraordinary. I was lost for words, you know. I had the video, right? I still have the video, of course. But they told me, you know, you got to turn to golf now. That's in your future now. And I said, what? I just want to hang out at the beach. They said, no. But it's tempting, right? I mean, it's tempting. It's so, the beach, the atmosphere is so surreal, isn't it? It's so surreal. If you make it that way. And I'm able to make it that way. I have the imagination and creativity to really just make it all seem so surreal. And you just feel like you're lost in another realm. You know, you're just in another realm. And the whole world just seems to disappear. And I'm chasing foam with my camera, you know, as I'm running down the beach chasing this line of foam, and I know it's going to turn out just amazing and slow it down in slow motion. It's just, I know I'm going to be able to make video that just seems like I was in another world entirely, another place entirely, where nothing, none of the laws apply that we have this world. There's nothing is even so different that this world here doesn't even exist at all. And so, you know, that's very compelling to do that. But now I have Dharma Prince responsibilities. Which is a bigger picture, you know, it's a bigger picture. And it'll be compelling in its own right, that is for sure. I'm sure of that. They never let me down, so I just trust them. So, no more beach for me. Right. I have to, you know, I get to help out. I don't have to. I get to help out, help others. I get to help them out in a, you know, really crisis, in a crisis. There's a big crisis coming, you know, really, very big crisis. So I get to help out with that. So that's, you know, super rewarding. Super rewarding. And I'll always, the beach will always be there. The Dharma Kings, if, you know, they need to return me there to some place, they will. I know they will. Maybe they'll send me to Pipeline for a while. I get to watch Pipeline and hang out there. Maybe next winter swell or something. Maybe I'll go to the Pipe Masters and watch the end of the, you know, the championship tour in the World Surf League, which I'm into. I check out all the stops on the tour. There's 11 stops. I went over every single one last night. Got familiar with every single one. I don't know if I can remember them all, but there's three in Australia. Snapper's Rock, Margaret River, and Bell's Beach. Was the first three. Then it shifts somewhere. Where does it shift to? I think Fiji. Goes to Fiji, I believe. And then I think it goes to Jay Bay, Jeffreys Bay. And then it goes back to like Tahiti. And then it goes like to, then it goes maybe to Trestles, Lower Trestles in California. Then it goes to, I think, France. And then it goes to Portugal. And then it goes to, it ends up in Pipeline. I know that. I might have forgotten one stop. But that's, pretty much, that's how it goes. 11 stops on the tour. Let me see if I got the three in Australia, and then Fiji, and then South Africa, and then Tahiti, and then Trestles, and then France, and then Portugal, and Pipelines. I'm forgetting one. Wherever that be. Oh, Brazil. Yeah, okay, that's it. So it goes from It goes from Bell's Beach to Brazil. And then from Brazil, I believe it goes to Fiji, and then it goes to South Africa, and then it goes to Tahiti. So those 11 stops. I got it. So I know all 11 stops already. And that'll take us through, I think, December, I think, is pipeline. Billabong, what, Pipe Pro there. And that, you know, that can determine the championship of the championship tour. And it's going to be an interesting year. But I'm sick and tired of backhand snaps from the goofy footers already. I mean, I can't take it anymore. And it's very boring. But that score, they get the scores out of it, so that's what they do. So, I mean, if there's a certain wave, that's how they surf it. What else can they do, really? So I want to see some more pipes. I hope at Margaret Beach, Margaret River, there's an alternative break they use called the box. And they just started using that in 2014. And that's a slab wave that breaks on this slab, underwater slab. And it's super hollow and fast and short. But the guys love it. They love it way better than the Margaret River break, which is a real slopey, thick shoulder. And you can't get barreled on it at all, really. Whereas the box is just this insane barrel. I mean, very gnarly wave. You can take really bad wipeouts there. And the guys love it. Kelly Slater loves it. He says, why in the heck weren't we surfing this in the first place? But the problem is it's not as reliable as Margaret River, so it doesn't always break. It's not always contest worthy. But when it is, look out. And the Margaret River starts the 29th of March. It's coming up in a few days. I think today, what's the date? The 26th. So in 3 days, it starts. I'm stoked. And there's supposed to be a huge swell coming in. Huge. For the first couple days of the competition. Huge. What day? Today's the 26th, only Saturday. So when's the competition start? Oh, that's weird. I mean, today's 26. Oh, okay, 26. 27. Starts on Tuesday? Tuesday? Is that possible? Maybe I got my dates wrong. I don't know. But I think it starts 29th. But anyway, they say it could be four times overhead. Four times overhead. This is a huge swell coming in. Wow, that is going to be interesting. Because if the box may be breaking, which is kind of just right, I think just north of it, real close by. It may be massive. You might have massive slab surfing to start off the competition. So Kelly Slater, you're going to get what you asked for. Right? But you're going to have, he's the best barrel surfer in history, Kelly Slater. And John, you know, is right there. He might be, you know, the best in the world, John, right now, those two. So we get to see these guys. I mean, Zeke Lau also. You know, you got some really, he's a great Hawaiian, he's a rookie, great barrel rider. You're going to get some great barrel riders out there, just could be, you know, just dealing with these insane slabs. And that's really going to, you know, going to be something to watch. Something to watch. I mean, in Snapper's Rock, Kelly Slater took off on this insane barrel from back behind the rocks, and Gabriel Medina had interfered. He didn't get called interference. He started taking off, and so then he pulled back, but he caused the wave to section and break too soon, you know, to break too soon, and Kelly Slater never came out of the barrel, and he didn't get called interference. A lot of people said that was interference. But if he had come out, that would have been just unbelievable. I thought he was going to come out. But I mean, he just completely disappeared. Way disappeared. And that's the thing. When you get really barreled, you don't know if they're going to come out or not. And you're just waiting. And when they suddenly just emerge out of nowhere, you just go, oh my God, they made it. It's fun to watch. If you add that in with everything else, which is what Slater does. That's why he's the best. He does everything. You're gonna see it all. When you watch Kelly Slater surf, you're gonna see it all. Whereas the goofy footers, all you see is backhand snaps. I mean, if you've seen one, you've seen them all. Come on. People are bored with that. They're already bored. A lot of complaints about Snapper's Rock, the judging and everything, which was amazing. I thought I was the only one who saw it. I said, wait a minute, this is something's not right here. Turns out there's a whole article in Surfline about this, and so many comments, and people are just saying they saw the same thing I saw. I said, wait, this is totally bogus. What do you mean? You give them that high score for just doing the same maneuver and over and over? What? It's boring. So there was a number of very, very questionable results in that contest. So hopefully that irons out in the next contest. And you get some, you know, more definitive stuff going on. So I can't go to the beach, so at least I can watch surf contests. But I get very nervous. It's not good for me. Maybe I'll calm down as I understand more what's going on. I'm a rookie. So rookies, are, you know, get nervous because I never watched surf contests before. First time. I did watch one at Steamers Link for a little while, but I didn't know what was going on. This is big time. This is the whole thing. This is the top. And so you're getting the best of the best watching this. So it's pretty interesting. But I get worn out by it. Nervous. I'm a nervous wreck watching it. And I get upset with the judges. But I gotta realize, hey, this is how it is. It is how it is. There's some favoritism applied. You know, there's some criteria that needs to be changed. But it's just judging. You know, and so you get that in any judging thing when there's judges involved. There's going to be disagreements. There's no doubt about it. And mistakes are made. You can see it. And a lot of people saw the mistakes that I saw. And so I realized, hey, I guess I got pretty good eyes because you have all these really veteran surfers. They saw the same stuff that I saw, that I first time I've ever seen a surf contest. I recognize all this stuff. I said, wait a minute. That's not the right decision right there. I can tell. And you get these experts coming in later, really top experts saying, look, there's a problem with the judging and this heat here, this thing, you know, hey, there's some issues here. Exactly what I saw. So that means I got really good surf eyes already. What I'm seeing is, you know, very valid. Of course, I have a history of surfing, but I haven't paid any attention to surfing since 1975. You know, it's been like, 42 years or so? I dropped it completely and I haven't paid any attention in 42 years. Nothing, zero. But I had the, you know, 10 years of surfing in, so I at least have a feel, some feel and comfort zone with it. We didn't do what they did, okay, surfing-wise. Nobody did what they're doing now back then, really. Not quite. They're the boards, everything has advanced so much. The speed, you know, it's just, I'm like, wow. With the stuff they do, I just, holy cow, that's amazing. I wish I could surf like that. I didn't even envision surfing like that. But now that I can see it, I say, well, I wish I was young, I could surf. You know, I said, I could really have a blast, you know. I'd be really good if I was young right now. Because I realize, oh, yeah, you can do this, and you can do this, and wow. I mean, when a wave section out, we like either straightened out or got pounded or something, or tried to kick out. But these days, you know, the wave section, they said, great. And they got to get so much speed, they just go up on it, on top of the section, and just do floaters. And then do maneuvers on the while they're doing the floaters. Or they just do an aerial. They see it, they just blast up and do an aerial and do a 360 and then just come down and do a floater on top of the section and then ride it out. Or they got so much speed that they can carve around the section and get back into the wall. You know, just like, holy cow. That's a whole different level of surfing they have right now. Yeah, it's cool. I like it. They can beat the wave. You know, whereas before the wave beat us. That's when I surfed, the wave just knocked the heck out of us. I mean, I started out with this big, heavy, long board, so slow. I mean, it's really, ultimately, you know, evolved into shorter boards, but we didn't have it dialed in at all, the way they have it dialed in now. Didn't have the speed. It didn't have the aerials. Didn't have any of that stuff. So you know, we were just trying not to let the wave beat us, but it usually beat us. And if we beat, but these days they just beat the wave. They just beat the wave. Oh my gosh. I said, if only we could have surfed that way back then, you know, 50 years ago. Wow. But so the fun that we had was trying to beat the wave. And I mean, I got crushed so many times. Like, you know, there's just, I've been through every, you know, being crushed by the ocean so many times. But that was part of it. That was part of it. You expected that. These days, a lot of times, you know, if they get crushed, it's pretty unusual. They usually beat the waves. And it's doing insane stuff on the waves, too. I say, well, that would have been a lot of fun to do it like that. And now I can see, I say, oh, my God, yeah. They take off behind the peak, you know, so they can get barreled because they're so fast. And I see these waves like breaking here in California. And I'm watching them and I'm saying, is it? And I was watching some surfers out there and they weren't making the waves, but the waves were like tremendous, just beautiful barrels, rights and lefts. But they were so fast, so fast. But then I saw a video. And we're just cooling down here from dying and seeing a whole new life. So I'm just sort of getting into my new life here. Okay, this is what you need to do in your practice. You have a new life. I mean, this a new life has been shown to me. And so I just have to get used to it. So I was watching this video of these professional surfers, you know, top, world-class top surfers out in San Francisco, surfing these same waves that I was seeing, watching. I watched this video, and they were making it. They were making the barrels. I said, you see, you can make these barrels. But, you know, if you're good enough, you can have, if you have the right board, okay. They're very technical about these boards now. I'm not really hip to exactly what they're doing. You have the right technique and the right board, and you're paddling. You cannot take off straight like you're going to do a bottom turn. You have to take off sideways on these waves and drop in sideways and make the sideways drop. So you're pointed down the line on your takeoff, already in, you know, full speed mode to make these waves. And then push it and push it. There's a way of pushing your board now that increases the speed. These guys are just flying. And they can make it. So these waves are makeable. I'm seeing, oh my gosh, you know, they're makeable. And I can see I could make them. If I was a young surfer now, I could make these waves. I could be out there surfing these waves. It'd be fantastic, you know, what a blast. But it's the takeoff, you know. I see these guys, they're still taking off straight. And they're dropping in straight. And then they're turning into the barrel. And then they're not going to make it. You can see that they're not going to make it. They start out making it, but they don't have enough speed. They're too far back and they don't have enough speed. And they don't quite make it. They get crushed. So the difference is paddling in the takeoff and being able to drop in sideways on the wave. Now you have to have the right fins to do that. You have to have the right fin setup, the right board setup, the right fin setup, and the right balance of mastering that move. And you're already jetting down the line full blast right off the bat, totally committed to it. And then you have to get low and just push, and then you can get to the shoulder. Eventually there's finally you can find a shoulder, but the ride to get to the shoulder is just extremely fast. From the get, the whole thing is like lightning. And I can see these surfers, they don't quite get it. You know, not all surfers get it. A lot of them are kooks. You know, we call them kooks. Most surfers, you know, are still, you know, they don't have the board knowledge as far as what kind of board do I need with my weight exactly and the fin setup and everything. And then the technique to make these waves. You got to put everything together to make it. Whereas the pros, they have their professional shapers that will shape for every venue on the 11 venue championship tour. They have a different board usually shaped for that particular wave. Okay? That's how technical they are now. And they may come with 10 boards for that. They have 10 boards for that beat, that break, and they try them out in practice to find out which one's exactly the best for it. And then the fin setup too. Whether it's, you know, tri, quad, or dual, whatever, how deep, how big the fins are, you know, and they tweak it to get it just right for that particular wave, the shape of the wave. And so obviously most of us don't have that, so we like buy a board. They're expensive now. Can't believe how expensive they are. And that board may only work for a particular wave. So what you have to do is you have to go to a local shaper. If you're going to surf like Ocean Beach in San Francisco, you'd have to go to a local shaper and say, look, this is my weight, size and weight, and I want you to shape me a board for these waves so I can make these barrels here at this break. And you pay a lot of money for that. I don't know how much it would cost to have someone shape your board. It might cost like $800 or something. I don't know. A lot. And you'd have to get a really good shaper who's really very knowledgeable. Or you could hire a shaper. That's really the only way to go. If you really want to have a good time and be successful, you have to get the right equipment for your size and weight for the particular waves that you're surfing. If they're fast waves, you know, or whatever waves. If you want to surf them, if they're slow waves, you have to have a board set up for that. If you have a real fast gun, super fast small board on slow shouldery waves, you're going to have a problem with that. You're not going to have the power to push the board. You got to get a medium to a board. But the thing about the barrels is you got the power to push a light, real light small board. And so it's skimming across the surface really fast because you've got the power of the barrels pushing it. So it doesn't start to sink down. If you see like Kelly Slater in the water, their boards, they're like, when they're sitting on their board, their board's like 3 feet underwater or something, or 2.5 feet. Because it's very small and light and doesn't have all the thick foam in it at all. So it doesn't float on the surface of the water at all. Not at all. They let the power of the wave push their board. Whereas most people have a lot of foam in their board. So it's as they're sitting on their board, the board's kind of sitting on top of the water. But for some reason, this doesn't go as fast. I don't know why that is, that's what they say. It's the small little boards, the light small little boards that go really fast. But they don't paddle as well. So you have to be a really good paddler. So there's another problem. Since they don't float well, it takes a lot of effort for you to paddle them. So, yeah, it's really interesting. And I'm sorry, I'm sort of getting clued into all this kind of stuff bit by bit by bit. I mean, there are good breaks if you were young, if you lived like near Margaret River or something, or you lived near Pipeline. You could surf almost every day of the year. They say, I think there's some places where you can almost surf every day of the year. I think that place in Portugal, they said something like that. There's always waves, good waves. So that you just go out every day, maybe 2 or 3 times a day. And you get really, really good that way. But if you don't have that, it was trestles, lower trestles. You could surf it 360 days of the year. That's what it was, lower trestles in San Onofre, California. But if you don't have that, then it's a real drag because you're searching for waves. And you're constantly looking at wave charts and then driving long distances and hoping the waves will be okay and hoping the wind is okay. And it becomes like this odyssey of trying to find decent waves. And it becomes expensive and that's... It doesn't work out well for you. Almost all the top surfers were born, lived near lived near a really good beach break or a good wave, and they went all the time. It was just always there for them. John Florence lived right near the pipeline. So since he was like 2 years old, he was going out. I mean, just right there. You just walk out your door, and go down the beach and start surfing. But otherwise, we had a nightmare. Just get up 4 a.m, go over. It's flat. We didn't have any surf reports back when I was surfing, so you had no idea what the waves were going to be like. No idea. You go over and you just hope. And, it's kind of flat there. Okay, then you drive up the coast. Let's go to a beach break up the coast. Or down. And it's not there. Let's go south. Then let's go back up the coast. And so we'd spend like hours and hours and hours just driving back and forth along the coast trying to look for some waves, just trying to find anything. And then the tide, so what with the tide changes, maybe the waves will change a little bit. And then the wind comes up, blows out. And lots of times, I ended up not even getting any waves at all. Nothing. It was just a wasted trip. But it was fun driving around searching for it. So you have to be into the search for the waves in order to get much enjoyment out of it. But you never get to be a very good surfer that way. You don't. So I never got to be a really good surfer, except when I was at UC Santa Barbara, where I surfed every day, sometimes twice a day. And then I started getting decent. I got to the point where I was a decent surfer. But I never was a good surfer. I was not a good surfer, just decent, where I could catch a lot of waves. I was able to finally catch a lot of waves and ride them successfully. But I didn't have all the new maneuvers down. I never felt that I was really having fun on the waves. I was surviving the waves. What happened? I got to the point where I was decent enough to survive the whole surfing experience, but never to the point where I was having joy or fun doing it. Which, that's what good surfers, that's when you're a good surfer, you're not just surviving the surf experience, you're thriving in it. You're thriving and having a blast and having so much fun. I never got to that point, which is a bummer. I regret that. I wish I had gotten to that point. I survived it. Previously, when I wasn't good, I got, thrashed by the surf experience, just beaten up by it. But I finally got to the point where I was surviving it and was like, you know what? I'm going surfing this afternoon, and great. It's going to be no problem. The next morning, no problem. The afternoon, no problem. And I just go out, and I felt like I belonged there, and everybody knew that I belonged there, and I didn't struggle. I was able to paddle so well that the waves didn't catch me inside. I was able to catch pretty much any wave I wanted to and ride it, decently, and paddle out and get another one. And just that, that's being a decent surfer. That's what I could do. So I reached the level of decent surfer, never reached the level of good surfer. But now I see. It's possible. I see what they're doing. Hindsight, taking a viewpoint now from just observer. It's different. You can see. And I'd approach it very differently. If I surfed again, I'd live at the beach. And I would know the tides. I would know the reefs. I would study it. I'd be a student of surfing first. Absolutely be a student of. I'd be a student of nutrition and fitness. You take Kelly Slater's example. He knows everything about the whole thing. He studies the waves. He knows. I'd study the shape of the wave for sure. The bathology of the wave, the undersea, how the undersea, what's causing it, what's pushing it. The currents, the swells, what direction the swell's coming, how does that affect the shape of the wave? So you already kind of know the parameters of what's going on out there. And so you develop this body of knowledge of all the parameters. And then you'd work on specific stuff. You'd say, I want to work on my bottom turns today. And so you spend the whole day just working on one maneuver. You wouldn't try surfing the wave like I'm Joe Surfer, No, I wouldn't do that. Just like golf, I just hit my pitching wedge at the range. That's all I do. Maybe people look at me like, who's this old guy just hitting his pitching wedge? What's that? Well, I know what I'm doing now. I'm smart now with golf. See, I'm smart at golf now. I'm building my confidence. I'm building my confidence. I'll hit 100 in a row good. Really good. Yeah, I feel like I can hit 100 in a row good. Before, I never felt that way. But I was trying to play golf and forget it. So I wouldn't be Joe Surfer. I would go out and I would just like practice just making like totally insane bottom turn. I just drop in, go line, just work on just radically carving that bottom turn over and over and over and over. And the rest of the wave, don't even care about it. I just do that one maneuver. Even if it's sectioned out, it doesn't matter. Just as long as I can make a great bottom turn and get the whole feel of the dynamic and the speed and everything and the rail and everything. And then I focus on something else. Cutbacks. You know, forehand snaps. Radical carves. Layback carves, you know, layback cutbacks. And then focus on barrels, getting barreled, and just focus on just that. You know, and so be able to understand the dynamics of all this stuff and have confidence in all of it. And only then do you start stringing it all together. And only then do you become a real surfer, actually. And only then do you become a good surfer. And so then, you know, become a good surfer where you can handle anything. You're going to get the maximum of any wave you see. You're going to be able to ride that in the right way. And people say, oh, he's a good surfer. Look at that. No, that's not a great surfer. That's a different story. Because they take risks and big waves, and they can surf any wave, including really big waves, and just, you know, shred them, and just, you know, that's different category. Those are the best of the best. But I could be a good surfer, you know, and you could become a really good surfer, but not a great surfer, but a really good surfer. The great ones are sort of freaks of nature, you know. They just sort of have capabilities that they could just do a little better, right? So fine, let them be that way. But you can be a good surfer again, so people watch you and say, wow, that's a really good surfer there. Respect, that's a really good surfer. They really know what they're doing. And it's fun to watch. Same thing with spiritual practice. You know, you could be really good. You're the guru of your practice. You'd be really good at it. That should be the goal. Be really good at it. That's what I've been able to do. So instead of being a really good surfer, I became a really good guru of my spiritual path, which is better than being a really good surfer. It's a lot better. Not saying you couldn't do both. Maybe Jerry Lopez did both. He's kind of got this meditation thing going on for sure. Some of them do. Combine the two. If you're a really good surfer, it's style too. You know, you're able to, you know, all the dynamics, all the moves, and then you work on style. Because you could do all that stuff. So what's most important? The beautiful wave, okay? To look beautiful doing it all. I mean, to make it all just seem like it's all meant to be this way. So you're like part of nature. This is just like you're now part of the play of nature. That's, to me, that's the highest surfing. I saw a tube of John Florence recently where he was like that. It was an overhead tube, and he could stand straight up inside the barrel. And he saw it. He saw it, and he knew it ahead of time. This is what he's going to do, everything. And so he drops in, and he sees it's overhead. He's okay. And then he's just standing there, like, kind of relaxed, and his arms at his sides, just like nothing at all is happening. I'm just part of the wave. He just was part of the wave in that barrel. And then when the barrel started closing down, more narrowing down, he had to crouch down to finally finish it off. But when he was in there, he was just, I'm not separate from the wave. I'm part of the wave. I'm not doing any maneuvers at all. I'm just part of the wave. I'm just part of the expression of this wave. That's what he did. And people love that. I mean, a lot of people kind of said, man, this, yeah, that's what we want to see right there. That's what we want to see. That's why John Florence is the world champion. I mean, he gets that part of it. He's been serving so long. He knows all the maneuvers, everything. And he can just allow himself to be part of the wave, make it seem like he's just part of the wave. It's not some surfer carving a wave up. This is just the wave expressing itself. It's a whole different level of surfing. And, you know, we talk about gurus, or whatever you want to call, say, in the Dharma kings. They're at that level with whatever you want to call it, freedom, in terms of they're just one. They make it seem like they're just one with everything that's going on. They're just one with everything that's just going on. The Tao, the ultimate Tao, the ultimate Taoist, so to speak. But this is, you know, way, that's the very toppermost kind of, right? Very few have reached that, where they're in the world, but not of it at all. You know? In other words, there's no separation, and therefore there's no me and a world. And if there's no me in the world, there's no world, is there? The world is only relative to us experiencing a world. But for them, there is no world. They're just part of the flow of freedom and creativity. So there's no more world. There's no me and there's no you. Then there's no more world, so to speak. So it's not like, I mean, if you want to understand, you know, the Tao, what they, you know, the one with nature, it's not actually like that. That's spirituality, being one with nature, spirituality. When you're one with the flow, there is no nature at all. There's no world. There's no world. There's just apparition. There's just intrinsic spaciousness decorating itself. That's all there is. So you cannot say, you know, there are those who, you know, there's the ultimate Tao, and then there's Taoism, but people think that you need to be one with the flow of nature and the waterfalls flowing, and this is one. You know, they're using words, but if you believe the words, then you're going to be spiritual. But really, there's nothing happening at all. There's no world happening at all. It's not me and the wave, and it's not the wave and me, so to speak. It's just experiencing, but it's beyond. There's nothing we can say about it, actually. The real Tao, there's nothing you can say about it. There's nothing you can say about it. So it's pointless. It's pointless. It's pointless. It's better to practice the wow than the Tao. I mean, don't try to be the Tao. Practice the wow. The Tao of wow. Okay? Just say you're practicing the Tao of wow. I'm a Tao of Wowist. I'm practicing. I'm not anything in particular, but I'm just practice. I'm just a yogin, which means I'm practicing. Which I'm practicing the Tao of Wow. Okay? I'm practicing the Tao of Wow. And that will get you there, but there's no there. Okay? It will get you. And there's nothing that can be said about it, right? It will get you where you want to go, but there's nothing you can say about it. There's nothing that can be said about it. There's no there. So how can you arrive? I mean, right, you can't. If there's no there, how can you arrive, right? You don't need to arrive because you're already there. And there's no there, right? You're already freedom. You're already freedom itself. And there's no there there. There's no world there. There's no there there. It's just all like magical apparitions. Intrinsic space is just decorating itself. With no goal. No things, no goal. Just apparition. Apparition-like. That's just a term. Apparition-like. So, practice the Tao of WOW. Practice the Tao of WOW. Be the guru of the Tao of WOW. Be a Tao of WOWist. Be a Taoist of the WOWist. Be the Taoist master of WOW. Practice. You can be your own Taoist master. Be the Taoist master of WOW. Practice the WOW practice. Just be that. Just be that. Like they say, the Tao that is the Tao is not the Tao. And it's the same thing. It's just labels. It's the same, whether it's ancient Chinese, you know, pre-warring states or warring states. It's all the same as it is right now. It's always been exactly the same. It's always been. Freedom has always been the same. It never changes. It never changes. God doesn't judge us because God knows we can't change. What is there to... God knows how God created us. God knows that we cannot change. So what possible use could God have for judgment? We can't change what we are. So what is there for God to judge? So God is not a God of judgment at all. There's nothing to judge. God created everything. God created is the same as it's always been. So and God knows it's perfect. So there's nothing for God to judge at all. So don't say that God is a judge, because that'll hook you into spirituality. That's the highest you can go with that. And it's totally not true at all. There's nothing to judge. Nothing for God to judge at all. How can you judge freedom? Perfect freedom. There's nothing to judge. So God is not judging us. There's nothing to judge. We haven't changed at all. So, I gotta get my golf groove on. I've been taking a rest from it. I'll let my body heal. I was pushing it so strongly. Wow, I'm just letting my body cool down. My weight's pretty good, 170. So I'm close to 169. I'm trying to push it so tomorrow morning I'll be 169. It's something, which is that's where I want to be. That's my golf weight, 169. My golf weight. And everything was there, but I just had to take this break. So I had to get back to it. I haven't been working out. I haven't been even stretching. I haven't been doing anything because I was just so wiped out by the effort I've been making. So wiped out by it all. So, but I'm letting everything cool down, calm down. And, you know, I'm getting reoriented now. You go through these periods of reorientation where it's so intense, you just got to hang on. You know, don't worry about anything else. You just got to make it through. And you make it through, but you feel, you know, you feel the strain of having made it through. You feel that, and that's what happened. I pushed through. I made it through. And now I needed to recover from that effort. So I'm doing that. I'm doing that. I'm starting to feel a little bit more perky. Starting to do some balance exercising. I swung the golf club a little bit yesterday. I'll probably swing it now. And start to do some stretching. Maybe do a little running. I'm probably going to start doing some running. And see if the knee can handle that. And full blast now. Full blast, okay. Full blast forward. And so we have a lot to consider here. A lot to consider here. Looping it back. Hey, you got to play golf. All right? I may invite you to play golf. Absolutely. Absolutely. Got to say yes. Yes, I got no choice. Don't say yes. Just say, I got no choice. So I'm going to do it. Done deal. Don't ever say yes. Just say, I have no choice. Just say, wow. Just say, wow. Got no choice. Wow. And then do it. You do it. It's like that. The whole practice that I've been part of, really, for 40 years is when I realized I had no choice. I had to do it. I had no choice. So I just said, I don't say yes. Yes means you have a choice. I didn't ever said yes. I just did it. So don't say yes, just say wow. Okay. The Tao of WOW. Okay, yeah. The Tao of WOW. Wow. What's the Tao WOW like? Wow. That's what it's like. It's wow. Okay. On the first tee. Great timing, too. Maybe it'll be in the summer where you can experience like blistering heat, too. So that makes it really intense. That's quite an experience, actually. I know how to handle that too. I've already been through it. You gotta get this towel that's big enough to wrap it around yourself, and you fill it up with ice, and you put that towel on your head, and you put a hat on that over that to hold it in place, and just let it melt over your head and stream down your shoulders, and you gotta golf like that with a rag on your head of ice bag on your head. Really, someone tipped me off that I was about ready to die of heat stroke, and they said, "Hey, do this. This is what we do out here. Put this, put the get soaking, put in, put a ice soaking cold water and with ice, put it on your head and just play golf that way." And I did, and that saved me. Plus, you hydrate, but you don't want to drink just too much water, straight water. You want electrolytes out there too. So you have to hydrate with, like, you would bring up some coconut water with electrolytes, sort of thing, like that. Plus you drink some water. Plus you take breaks in the shade. You take breaks. Plus you walk slow. You walk slow. You don't do any extraneous motions. You just walk. So it's really amazing spiritual practice. You watch calmly and slow. You don't take a bunch of practice swings. You get to your ball, you step up, you hit it, you walk calmly and slowly back to your cart, you drink some water, and you start driving like that. It's a very intense spiritual practice playing in intense desert heat. It's a tremendous spiritual practice. You have to be very disciplined. No foolishness, no fooling around. You got to do everything right. You don't go running around. You'll drop. You don't go looking for your ball. If your ball's in the bushes, it's gone. Just drop one. Here, just drop one. But we'll be playing best ball, so we probably don't need to worry too much about that. Because if you start go traipsing around in all the bushes and say, you're gonna wear yourself out in the heat. You gotta minimize the exertion of it all. And also just stopping wherever you are. I say, I'm just gonna sit in the shade here for a while and just listen to the cicadas buzzing and calm my heart rate down. then you feel the peace of everything and the silence and the calm. And it's powerful, powerful experiencing. Just don't move. You don't move. Nothing is moving. Nothing is even stirring. And yet everything is vibrant. In the light, the intense light, it's so vibrant. And at rest, just as it is. And you just sit there like that and just experience. Ah, it's a very powerful spiritual experience. It's just, I love it. It's just beautiful. But you pay the price for that. Because in the summer, there's nobody out playing golf there, so you can do that. And you got the course to yourself. So you could just stop for 20 minutes if you want. And just take a 20-minute wow break. And it's like an altered state of consciousness, to say the least. One of the best altered state of consciousness you can get. But you pay the price, you have to, you know, make sure you do everything right. No fooling around. Serious business. When it's 115 degrees out, it's serious business. You know, your mind has to be right. My mind wasn't right the last time I went down there. But there was a sandstorm, so I couldn't play. But I didn't go there to play golf. I went to attend a conference, the Dharma Kings. They were help cluing me into what you're going to do. I had to be clued into it all. So it wasn't about playing at that point. But it was 115 when we drove in. 150, but next day, huge sandstorm, and couldn't see anything. It was so windy. The weather was terrible. I didn't feel like playing. I was too tired anyway. I wasn't in good enough shape. Wasn't in good enough fitness shape to do it all. But now, it's a different story. My mind is now, you know, really focused on this, of doing this. I have the shirts for it, you know. I've geared up the right shirts, and I'll keep, you know, gearing up for it in the right way. Right shoes. So yeah, I'm getting focused on this now. This is where it's at right now. Where it's at. Got to make it through this danger time. Got to make it through. We're in last call time, dangerous time, the most dangerous time. If you're an alcoholic, that's the most dangerous time of all. Anybody can talk a good game at the bar, okay? Like, oh yeah, you know, what are you having? Well, I'm just having ginger ale. Oh, really? Yeah, I'm sobering up. Oh yeah, man, this program is helping me out. Oh, great. So, why are you hanging out in the bar? Well, you know, I just kind of, you know, I like to be with the friends, the camaraderie, the atmosphere, you know, I miss it. You know, I don't want to just hang out in my house. I might start drinking there, but if I'm around all my friends, it's fine. Oh, okay. So, you're sipping your ginger ale and having your finger foods and stuff, and laughing and talking, and, you know, convivial atmosphere. You just say, ah, I'm doing it, you know, wow, this is great. And the bartender says, okay, everybody, last call. Closing down in 15 minutes. Last call. Anybody want a drink? Last call. And then you start shaking. Then the shakes start happening. And he says, how about you? You know, how about you? Well, yeah, I'll just have a little with my ginger ale. I'll just have a little, you know, last call. I'll just have a little bit here. Drink that and say, okay, last call. Just a little. I mean, this is my last chance. I'll just have a little less. That's okay. And then, oh, wow. I missed that. I didn't realize how much I missed that. Here, bartender, just give me one more. I'm just before I go out the door. Before you go out the door. Oh, wow. Now you got a buzz going. You say, hey, the liquor store's still open. Let's go down to that. I just feel like, you know what? This is my last drink I'm ever going to have anyway. So let me, I'm going to have a few more. Let me do it all right. What the heck? I'm feeling great anyway. Next thing you know, you pass out drunk. You passed out. Then you suddenly lost all your confidence. You're like, I can't do this. I can't do this. Okay? So, last call is the most dangerous time. The most dangerous. So, you want to be called out of the bar. Someone wants to call you and say, hey, you got to go play golf. And you got to say, hey, buddies, I got to go. My boss is calling me. I got to play in a golf tournament. So I got to see you later. Oh, really? You're not going to stay till it closes? Nah, I'd like to, but I have to do this. My boss is, you know, telling me I have to do this. So it's really helpful if you feel you got some boss, you know, that's telling you, you got to do this. So this is why there has to be some authority in the spiritual scene. Because if you just say, oh, a friend is calling me to go play golf, and they say, well, look at your friends. Bro, aren't we your friends? Oh, yeah. Just tell them you'll do it later. You did 10 minutes from now, 15 minutes. You tell them you're going 15 minutes. Oh, okay. And then you say, and last call gets you like that. So that's why it's so important that there be some authority at this time. You got to say, my boss is telling me I have to play this tournament. I got to go right now. I'm on the first tee. I'll be late. I got to go right now, but I'll see you guys later. You have to have that leverage right now. You have to have the leverage. So you say, the Dharma Prince is telling me that I got to go play golf with him. I got to go. I'm a yogin. This is my, you know, superior, you might say. This is my boss. And when the boss says to the yogin, this is what you got to do, I got no choice. I got to go. I got to go right now. That's how it is for a yogin. Okay, so you have to have that leverage. And this is something that I'm trying to introduce this because I'm seeing how important it is. Otherwise, if it's just a friend, you'll stay with the friends. You say, yeah, okay. You can always tell a friend later, can't you? You can always tell, but not your boss. You can't tell your boss later. So the Dharma Kings are your bosses, ultimate bosses. I'm their spokesman. And I'm telling you, the Dharma Kings are saying, you got to come play golf with me. So you got no choice. You got to do it now, you see. And then that pulls you out of last call at the bar. And you leave your friend and say, I'll catch up with you guys later. And you know what? They'll say, okay. Oh, your boss, okay, we understand. I'll catch up with you. Now, what can they do? You got to pull rank on your friends. You got to. So you got to say, I am an apex yoga. I'm an apex wow yogin. I am an apex wow yogin. Which means then you got to answer to your superiors. You got to answer to them. You're not all on your own. You the leverage that you need. You need the leverage. And they'll say, well, yeah, you don't know how to play golf. So, no, it doesn't matter. If the boss tells me I'm playing golf, I'm playing golf. You know, I have no choice. So this whole thing, I have no choice, is very important because really, you have no choice but to be an apex wow yogin. You don't have any choice, right? It's not yes or no. You realize, I got no choice. I have to be successful. I have to realize I'm successful in my freedom because God created me that way. There's no way I can not be successful. There's no way I can not be free. So I'm perfectly successful at freedom and even beyond that, right? So I have no choice but to be a yogin. I have no choice. No choice at all. And therefore, I have to answer to the Dharma Kings and I've got no choice. This is part of the deal, you know. I got no choice, so I got to do it. Then this gives you this tremendous leverage. We'll see who answers to this. So the men have to play golf, and the women have to decide whether they're going to be a goddess or a guru of their own path, of their own practice. That's what they have to sort out. The men are just waiting for them to sort that out. But as we wait, we have to play golf. Okay, let's play golf. This is responsibility of an apex yogin. So we'll see who answers the bell. I'm waiting. You know, I'm waiting. I've already answered the bell. So here we go. Very great. That's it for this one. Wow.